Surf, who's the creator of internet, or the World Wide Web as we call it, wrote a letter to the 25-year-old, you know, I mean, so to say. And he talked about three things. He wrote to his 25-year-old, who's young, right? 25 is young, Amit, like you, right? And he said, first, there is a danger of the internet becoming a propaganda tool, and it is already happening. The second is this fake news, false news, which is linked to propaganda. And third is the security of information. For the first time, you know, I know the sales of the book 1984 have gone up, George Orwell's classic, which he wrote in 1942. And the scenario he painted in 1942, where states will kind of swoop on privacy and they create mayhem, I mean, it's in some way happening. I mean, definitely in the US, you know. So I think media has a role to play there. There is a fight for the soul of this country happening right now. You know, I won't make political statements here, but I think there is a fight for the soul of this country happening here. And media has a very important role to play. And sometimes we in the media, when we are asked to bend, we crawl. Amit, right? And that is the problem. We have to keep our spine straight. We are not here just for profit. Of course, sustainability is important. We have to pay 200 people's salaries, so on and so forth. And if you're not financially independent, you will compromise another, right? So I think media understands its role. Right now, there is an existential dilemma for people in the media business, what to do, what not to do. There's a new normal. Governments are always control-oriented. They want propaganda to go out. So whether it's this government or the last government, I mean, governments generally are. I'm not making a comment on this government, but generally governments are. But having said that, if you do constructive criticism of issues and not people, and that is the tough part, you know, drawing a line. The people in power have to understand that that criticism in some way keeps them in check and ultimately makes them successful, right? If they listen to this. So I think there is a lot of soul searching happening right now. We're trying to find our feet in a new normal. I mean, I can say that for my friends in media and being a media professional myself, and I am sure that, you know, most of us are in media not just for money. I mean, money is important. We're in some way there to make a difference, right? Because if we don't make that, we'll anyway not make money, right? So we have to make that difference, and we understand. And I can say, knowing every media owner and every journalist and editor in this country, they have a social conscience. But as I said, right now there is a lot of soul searching happening. Right now there are existential dilemmas, both from a business model, because of internet, digital, government. You know, there is a lot coming at us. And we are doing a very tough job in a very, very difficult scenario. I mean, GCs, right? They, as I said, they kind of, their job is to bring out topics or issues in their serials, in their programming, which sometimes we know, we talk about it as when we are together, but we are so hypocritical, we don't talk about it openly, right? So in some way, when they talk about it, when a GEC or it is making it socially acceptable, right? So I think we are in safe hands in the country, and there is diversity of viewpoints. If there is a certain pro, then there are enough anti. So I think there is a kind of balance. There are all kinds of viewpoints right now. And that is the beauty. There is a multiplicity of media in India. And I think it won't go away in a hurry. And somewhere we'll find the balance between making sure we are true to our audiences and we are also true to our balance sheets.
Thank you so much, Anurag. Since you mentioned soul searching, I will take the privilege of such a distinguished panel over here and ask you all a question that we as women are soul searching about, is that we want to come out and be more present, participate more in the media, in the social media, like you rightly said. We have to reclaim that power, know that today we can, on the social media, put our voice out. A very famous journalist, she said that if you are successful as a woman, you should prepare to be hated. You should be prepared to be hated. How much do you think that is true? Because we see a lot of trolling happening on social media, which makes very difficult for women to really go out and express themselves. They have families, and they have a more sense of, oh my God, what is this person going to, they get more affected by negativity and slander, abusive slander being thrown at them. They're not prepared for the street fight that it sometimes can become, that world. Of course, this is the digital media. This is real people. What advice? So that's why I said this is really not about you. This is really picking your brains on what advice would you give to women who are entering this space until the time, like Anurag says, we find our balance and we find a consciousness on social media that is appropriate to reflect the state of the society we live in. What message would you give to women who are daring to be out there and daring to use this power of social media to put their sensibility out there? Kartike and then Raji.
I'll break it in two parts. One, I will clarify when I say how even a GEC channel can play a role in changing mindsets. I mean, I'll give two, three examples of our own channel. We were the first to do something on child marriage in this country. You know, Balika Vadhu is a show you mentioned. We are the first channel, you know, to touch on a taboo subject which is now on air, on transgender. You know, in fact, when the creative team transgender, everybody was like, are you sure you're going to put it on a GEC channel? And we said, yes. Because you have to take that leap of, we were the first channel to do on bonded labor, and people said bonded labor doesn't exist in India. And when I was doing the press conference with Mahesh Bhatt in Delhi, a journalist told us, few kilometers from here, there was bonded labor. So bonded labor exists. So television that way reflects what's happening in society. You can then make it in an entertaining way and still get that messaging going. Coming back to your question on women wanting to get out there, speak, and things like that, the beauty about social media is that the power in your hands, just like the broadcasters today, with due respect, can go on giving one narrative to you, you have the same advantage. Go on tweeting one narrative, whatever you feel like. Because if you're in public space, you have to, the thing is nobody can come and beat you up. They can tweet back to you, let them tweet. There's nothing wrong, we're in a democracy, let them tweet, let them disagree with you. And even if they troll you, how does it matter? Ignore them, mute them, block them, and continue. But you can't get scared and say, I will not what I want to say, and restrict your freedom of speech because you're worried somebody is going to troll you or abuse you on social media. You know, the best thing is, I can say anything to Anurag now, give him the choices of the abuser. Truth is, unless he decides to accept it, it's gone in the wind. But if I punch him in his face, then there is a difference. That's the beauty of social media. I would never dare do that with Anurag. You've seen his size and you've seen my size. I would never even take that risk. But having said that, that is the beauty of social media. If you use it effectively, if you use it, whether it's Twitter, Facebook, anything, if you use it effectively, it's a very potent tool. And if when women come together, there's another march happening in the US today, you know? It's on my Twitter, because they send me inbox messages saying, Raj, can you retweet for us and things like that, right? Because they saw me when the marches were happening, I was like supporting them and things like that. And my daughter went for the march in New York City. But I genuinely believe women globally today are a really dominant force. And when they make their voices heard, nobody can ignore it.
I'll take it up from where Raj left, and I'll say that although I run a news network, and we do whatever it is in our power to actually get out that perspective as far as the news aspect is concerned. But being a media entity, it's important to understand how we can actually bring about the change which can affect women coming from different backgrounds to voice their opinions, whether it's on social media or otherwise. I'll give you an example. We run a company called Pro Wrestling League, Pro Spotify, which started the Pro Wrestling League about 2 years ago. And it's the first commercial sports league in the world which has equal representation from male and female wrestlers. Now, You know, when one thinks about wrestling, and then why is wrestling more important for me in that sense, is it's symbolic with power. It's the oldest sport in India. It is the biggest export from India to the world as a sport. It can be traced back to thousands of years. And today, you know, in the last Olympics, the performance that got us majority of recognition was again from a woman wrestler, which is Sakshi Malik. Now, the point I'm trying to make here is because in a country which is patriarchal, which has a particular mindset, today women have managed to actually beat men at their own game. And it doesn't become more apparent than the people who have actually arrived in that space. So these people, whether it's Sakshi or Geeta Fogart or the Fogart sisters, and long before these movies were made on wrestling, did we come onto this platform with the simple intent that it comes in the forefront and they actually voice their opinions, and when they become stars and what they say, it becomes very important and relevant to society at large, to the whole country. And I think they are a great case in point here as to what they say and how they say and what they say about things makes a huge impression on the polity of the country. And I think the whole trolling business is, again, the bias is very much in our minds. With all due respect, we have to be equitable to males and females. We cannot even say that only females are trolled and men are not trolled. I think that'll be incorrect. Even men are trolled as much as females are, and I think that bias needs to be removed at an intrinsic level as far as we are concerned. And these people who come from a very humble background, these people who come from a very, very, perhaps the epitome of a patriarchal society in India could be a state like Haryana, where female feticide was the highest in the country till about 15 years ago or 20 years ago. And I'm very proud today that that's the state which has produced the maximum amount of female wrestlers. Not only that, and I think this is where the role of people like Raj and Anurag and myself come into, becomes more important, because it's not about what we can do for them, but it's what about we can do for the ecosystem which becomes conducive for them. So let me give you another example, another first. PWL in season 2, we had another Olympic medalist who played. Her name is Maria Amri, who comes from Tunisia, and this is the first woman female wrestler to win an Olympic medal. So again, there's another first from that, and this only goes to actually showcase that it's not something which is happening in India, but it's happening globally. And I'm glad that we are in the center of it in as far as this aspect is concerned in India when it's happening globally. So I think we have come a long way, and there's no need for us to be apologetic as far as the women are concerned for their success and achievement, and they are just doing a fantastic job.
I want to make a point. You asked about, at the start of your question, you said, you know, successful women should be mentally prepared to be kind of hated. And I'll tell you, it possibly is true. It possibly is true. And I read, you know why Donald Trump won? Do you want to know why Donald Trump won? Do you want to know? Do you know why he won? Do you know or you don't know? You know or you don't know? Okay, you would see. My nutritional therapist told me that. Rachna told me that. So it's not original. She said the Americans have been eating junk food for a long time. And when you eat junk food, your brain makes the wrong choices. So that's how Donald Trump won. But that's on a serious note, a New York Times columnist wrote, and he's a very famous author, he wrote that Hillary Clinton lost because not only she came across as an ambitious woman, she actually came across as an ambitious man. Now, you know, what's wrong with that? And I want to say this to all the women. There is this research which says that to start something new, men have to be 60 or 50% sure to start something. If they're 50, 60% sure about starting a new venture, doing a new thing, starting a new initiative, doing something, they do it. Whereas women need to be 90 to 100% sure. So I want to say to women in this room and people who will possibly amplify it on social media that, you know, you don't need to be 100% sure. Like men, you can be 50, 60% sure. I mean, sometimes you're not even 10% sure, at least me. I don't know about these two gentlemen. I was born in Haryana anyway. We don't think too much, right? So I think women have a new place And as Rajji said, we can't deny that. And I also must add to what Karthik said, the relationship between men and women is of independence and interdependence. You know, men can't live without women, so to say, either mother, daughter, sister, wife, friend, whatever, right? Partner, whatever. Similarly, women need men. So, you know, it's not a relationship of animosity. It's a relationship of interdependence. And I think the mutual respect has to come. It is, you know, you can't say it is a relationship of animosity. Yeah, that's right. Because sometimes women forums become that. Men versus women. No. In my view, it is about interdependence. That's what I feel.
I'll take the opportunity to ask some, have some questions from the floor here. If somebody would like to ask something, we'll, as I take benefit from the opportunity, before we come to the close of the session, Smita Joshi from UK, please.
For somebody that really doesn't enjoy television or serials, you know, the Shani serial is just incredible. I mean, it digs very deep into the Puranas and the Shastras and, you know, makes it into something that is actually really watchable and educational and entertaining. Your channel has a slightly different flavor to others. I just want to know what your ethos is. What is at the core that's driving the shows that you're making, and especially in that vein, that are historical or spiritual?
I think I'll just add to Smita's question as well, which is on the same thing. What is it that such highly Indian content makes for global audiences? What is it?
Whenever we have a few things in our DNA, okay? One is we have to be different, we have to be disruptive, our content has to be, it has to be cutting edge, our production values, those are all hygiene factors. But coming to your thing, what we try and do is we are very clear in our minds that we are in the business of entertainment. And because we are a single TV household, 95%, okay, single TV household, we have to cast our net as wide as possible to try and attract different people like you. You don't watch serials, you don't watch it. Now suddenly you got hooked on to Shani. If I can get on to different people for different show. So first is we try to see as much variety that you can give on the channel. I don't think there is any other GEC channel that gives you as much variety as colors. On one end we have Big Boss, and the other end you have Shani, you know, totally contradicting each other. At the same time, we also believe, and we seriously, you know, people tell me Big Boss, oh, you know, it's a voyeuristic show and things like that. But you know what I say? It is a show. It is a show on education, on human behavior. That's what Big Boss is all about. What happens in your lifespan, whatever you live now, 70 years or 80 years, everything that happens within your family, within your corporate life, within your social circle, the fights, the angst, the thing. Now just imagine, it's the same thing, you compressed it in 100 days. Let me tell you, if you had to compress your life, put people all together, and make it that your lifespan is just 25 years, it would burst even bigger than Big Boss. So that's the way we look at it. We look at it as an education program on human behavior. So we believe every show that we do, in some way, should reflect or give back to society. People have come and told me about, like yesterday we launched a show called India Banega Manch. We do India's Got Talent. How is India Banega Manch is different? We could have gone and got the same talent for India's Got Talent. I'm sure if we auditioned, the same people would have also applied. But the thing is, through this show, what we have done very cleverly, if you see, we are showcasing India. We are showcasing incredible India, and the talent to whom we are giving a stage, whom I call incredible Indians. They are incredible Indians, and we are showcasing incredible India, and being doing it in a manner which is like there is no stage, no studio, no judges on the outside the iconic locations of this country. And the technology that we use, where the votes are counted based, the camera counts how many number of people have gathered, and that's how you count the votes. Now, it does many things. One is, there is this fervor at this moment within the country. So we are riding the wave to an extent, okay? There is this whole thing about it being differentiated. And at the same time, for a viewer, it's a clutter breaker. It's something completely new. So all the time, we try and to do, try, you know, the brief to the programming team is, people will think, you know, I'm just saying it for effect. Truth is, we really don't give a damn what the other channels are doing. Okay? We don't. What we do, we see what other channels are doing, we keep a track of what they're doing, and we're saying, if something is really nice, can we make it better? Can we, if something really good? But in most cases, we say, how are we going to make it different? The single line brief to the programming team is, you have to keep reinventing and you have to compete with yourself. That's the thing. We are competing with ourselves all the time. And let me tell you something about creative people. My programming head is a woman. All the people who work for me, majority of them are women. My head of marketing is sitting here. She's a woman. Okay, I told you, I'm surrounded by women. And the thing about creative people is they get bored very fast. You have to keep challenging them all the time. All the time, you have to keep challenging them and pushing the envelope for them to excel and do even better. Because that's what, because their potential is so high. It's just that you need to give them newer challenges. We did a show, I'm plugging my channel here, and you know, why not? I've flown all the way from Bombay. But we did a show called Rising Star. The first television show in India or in Asia was live every Saturday, Sunday. And when we did it, 3 days before, I must tell you this, my programming head said, are you sure? Because in the 6 years I've been in the company, there's not been a single board meeting where in the conference room, the computer has worked properly. Either the projector doesn't work, either the sound doesn't work, or the screens don't come on. Not a single time. Okay? And then you're saying, are you crazy? You're going to go to live with the show every Saturday, Sunday on air? And honest to God, there were butterflies in my stomach. Okay? But I said, if we don't do it, we will never know. And what's the worst case scenario that can happen? The screen will go blank. Right? Keep some content, keep some other taped program. If it goes blank, just put it and we'll address it. Touch with God's grace, we had a successful season. Now it is the new normal. And you'll see other broadcasters following us. So I think it's just, you have to try and differentiate, because the consumer today has so many choices, so he has to feel kuch naya mil raha hai, you know, kuch naya mil raha hai all the time.
Yes, please, yes. Hello, my name is Shiva Rajan Thampi. I'm a proud Naya woman from Kerala. I think you're from Kerala, I'm not very sure. Okay. Have you ever considered doing something on the only existing matrilineal community existing in Kerala, where it's the only place where I take my mother's name, where the woman is the head of the family, but somehow it's dying and nobody is bringing, you're talking of Balku, all those other things. How about something, doing something on the matrilineal system? I'm very proud of it. My children take my name. I take my mother's name. Maternity is a certainty, as we say. Paternity is only a possibility. And
my
I was
wife
wondering,
reminds
can
me
I give
about
you something to think about?
My wife reminds me about it all the time. She says, maternity is a certainty, paternity is a question mark. I told this to you once. Who would know better if your wife is a Malayali and they come from a matriarchal society? Yesterday I was with my friend Anirban Bla, and he's from, I think he's a Khasi, and again they have a matriarchal kind of system. It's not that we don't think about this. There are lots and lots and lots. The beauty about India, there is so much treasure in this country. There's so many topics on which you can do shows. It's unbelievable. Unfortunately, as a channel, you have 5 hours of, or 6 hours of original programming, and when a programming is doing well, you don't want to replace it. You want to squeeze it as much as long as it goes. That's the problem. Having said that, one of the challenges we do have in India, in a country with a population of 1.4 billion, okay, we don't have good writers. You'll be shocked if I tell you that. Getting good writers is a huge challenge for us. And the few writers that you get, they do one show, they're successful. Next moment, they want to do a movie. They want to do Bollywood. Even if they get paid less there, they make more money here, they get paid less there. But if you go and see in the US, a Shonda Rhimes will say, movie, I'm not interested in doing it. Okay? The writers there want to do television. In India, it's just the opposite. That's the challenge. But you know what? It's crossed my mind many times. And there are many other shows. We did a show called Krishna Dasi. It's again a South Indian show, which we did it in Hindi. So there are things which we want to do, and it's there at some point. Hopefully, you'll see it on Colors.
Hi.
Doc. Oh. Who's that? Somebody with the mic?
I have the mic. Okay. Hi, my name's Dr. Marissa, and I'm from California. Over there, I have a talk radio show. I'm a journalist on CNBC News Radio and iHeartRadio. And on my show, I say there's no gossip, no scandal, no K words, no Kardashian talk, and no CNN, no constantly negative news. And lately, no T talk either, no Trump. But anyways, keeping it without politics, yes. I agree with the first question. I tell my listeners, don't listen to the news, because if it bleeds, it leads. Right? We go to the worst common denominator. We put in things that bring out the worst in people, or report on people that do the worst in society. So as leaders in the media, is it true, I've heard this, that out of 50,000 possible things to report in the news, whoever is the producer and their biases towards what they want to put out there, whether it's to let you feel fear or let you feel insecurity or let you think that everything is going to H-E-L-L in a handbasket, then they choose those news titles to sway the way media or what the belief systems or the BS, the belief systems that are predominant. And as one of my teachers, Dr. Michael Bernard Beckwith, says, that media has become a weapon of mass distraction. So please speak to that.
Well, I think I'll pick up from what I said earlier and what Raj and Anurag also said earlier, that as far as media is concerned, you know, it can't be in one particular light and cannot be seen in one particular definition either. Yes, you're not supposed to have your personal beliefs and your personal ideologies broadcast on your network or printed on your newspaper or your website, but the matter of the fact is that we are no different from a judge, for instance. You know, a judge is also a member of a society. He or she is also exposed to the rigmaroles of society, to the news that takes place. Very often, judges swear that they will not be affected, or as in US it is the case of the juries, that they will not be affected in any which way by whatever happens around them or surrounded them. And you have to keep your biases outside when you take those important decisions. So whether it's for a juror or for a judge or a media man, they all are confronted with the same predicament or dichotomy, that to what level will they understand and what level will they communicate what do they think is right and wrong based on their understanding and their ideology, and what will they present to you without having any influence of that. So I think it's a perennial problem. It's not something which is new. It has been in existence since journalism was invented and has been there in its different manifestations, and will continue. This debate will always continue. I think the key difference is to what Raj said earlier. Each and every person has the ability to put out their thoughts and opinions on out there and articulate it very effectively. So in most of the broadcast networks, you'll see what hashtag is trending or what hashtag they put out is the opinion and or is the view that they're taking on a particular story or the stand. Now, having said that, the right to dissent and the right to change the channel, the right to not watch it, and the right to move away and to watch whatever you want to watch is your intrinsical right. And that's what sets you apart from the others. So I think we believe in self-governance. We don't believe in regulation. We don't believe in any sort of third-party regulation in Indian media, which will tell us what to do, what not to do. And if someone chooses to do something out of their own free will, and they want to choose a particular line, which is either left or right, or left of the center, or right of the center, that's entirely their call, and the call of the viewers who want to watch his or her program. So I think in an evolved democracy, and in which is, frankly, something which is a work in progress in India right now, I would say, and world over, we are coming to terms with it, and it's something which the viewers will ultimately have to decide, where people will decide what they want to watch, and if people don't watch it, it will not survive. So hence, irrespective of whatever the motive is, whether it's commercial, whether it is something else, if people will not watch you and then the content will not be consumed, that's the end of that content. So it is a market economy system which corrects itself, and I truly believe in that. I'll pass on the remote to
you. Said it all.
I also want to tell you, while we're discussing technical things, Vishalini, you wanted to ask a question if you want. I know these two gentlemen personally, and I know with all humility, everybody who matters in advertising, marketing, media. I can tell you, people like these, that I was showing Sapangeet what is the name I scored for him. I embarrassed him one day. I showed him what they're very responsible people, and they're very normal people in their life. They're very, so if you have leaders like these, I am lucky to know Karthike and Raj. I can say they're the two most affable, likable, without doing, trying to do that, and very, very conscientious. So if that's the kind of people leading media, whether it's a journal entertainment channel or a news network or whatever, I think as a nation, as a community, we're in safe hands. They're responsible people. So all this talk about media being, as I said, we are trying to do a very difficult job in a very difficult scenario. And there is a new reality luckily yesterday Macron won. But imagine if Le Pen had won in France. We're moving towards the right everywhere. So I think in some way, we have a role to make sure people distinguish between propaganda and real news. Real issues differentiated from propaganda. And that's a tough one, right? And sometimes people in the media business beat down the people in the media business. We cannot be cynical about our community. We have to look in the context of what it operates. You can look down on CNN. In my view, it is the best news channel, my view, okay? Donald Trump can hate it, you can hate it, but I think it's the best news channel in the world. It has a certain bias, but it states it upfront. Unlike in India, where channels have biases, some, not all, some have biases, but they don't state it upfront, right? So I think you have to applaud these gentlemen who lead our media industry. I think that's what I want to say.
Sorry to interrupt, Anurag, but we have been joined by a very special guest this afternoon. Please put your hands together to welcome the Honorable Minister of State, Broadcasting Company of India, Mr. Rajyavardhan Singh Rathore. It is absolutely my pleasure to welcome, please. It is my pleasure to welcome Minister, Honorable Minister of Information and Broadcasting, Mr. Rajyavardhan Rathore, a man of many talents, which we shall all discover very shortly. Sir, thank you so much for your presence. He had to travel today, but he had committed
a man of his word, a man of discipline. It's an absolute honor to have you with us. And it's wonderful that we have a panel on media already here with media stalwarts. And we have the Minister of Information and Broadcasting here. We'd love to welcome you, sir, and request you to maybe sit down.
The finance minister is not yet tax clapping, so you can clap for the minister. Can you? Can you give him a... It's also good for your heart. When you clap, it kind of relaxes your muscle. So I just wanted...
Honorable Minister, this is the Women Economic Forum, which has attracted women from 100 countries to come to India. So they've come from far and wide, and we'd love to hear your words of opening and encouragement to the women who have come here from different parts of the world to Mother India.
Thank you, Harbin. Thank you so much. I'm grateful to the panel as well. I really don't know what you were discussing, but I'm sure it must have been very valuable and worthwhile. My greetings to everyone who's present here in this room, and I believe that you come from far and wide. I believe each one of you is very accomplished in their own fields and have been doing a lot of work worthwhile, adding value to your society and all around the businesses, making a difference of where you are. So I believe the entire gathering is absolutely empowered. I think in the last couple of years that I've been able to go to the rural areas, I see, of course, I've been blessed with a lovely wife and a lovely mother, and I don't think so I could have achieved anything in my life without their support. And so I value the wisdom and the spirit that they are able to imbibe in me, the inspiration they are able to give to me, the support that they are able to give to me. I value all that. I also sense, because my wife is a professional, she's a doctor, she's been in the army as well. My mother has been a teacher as well. So I sense and I realize the potential in each one of the people in my household and also in this society. And therefore, when I go to rural areas, that's where I sense that they have the same dreams, they have the same aspirations as we all do in urban areas. It is just that they don't have the right opportunities. And I think that's where all of you who are individually empowered can actually make a difference to the society at large. So together, your forum that you have, I believe you've been doing wonderfully well, and you have a great connect throughout the world. So I think that's something that you can really leverage from the great potential of people that you already have, of making a difference in this society. I mean, just imagine, it's truly about awakening the society, really. The Prime Minister spoke about, we have a scheme called Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, basically to empower a girl child. Now, he spoke about that and he launched it about a year and a half ago in Haryana, which is one of the states which has probably one of the worst sex ratios compared to boys and girls. In just 1 year, there's been a change in the birth of number of birth of girls from 861 to 889. Now, in just 1 year, if that difference can come, it's only because of awakening the society and making them realize their potential. So a lot of things can be done. He's, of course, speaking about cleaning India, wherein people feel that people have always felt that it's impossible, right? But the point is that we all want it to happen, and wherever we believe that we can put our effort, things will change. So a lot can be done with all the women, all the powerful women that you have here. So I'm really grateful to be present here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that very inspirational opening, urging each one of us to reach out and go out to our lesser privileged sisters and be there for them. And that's exactly what each one of them is doing in her own way. My next question to you, Honorable Minister, is some of you might already know from India that Honorable Minister has served in the army for 23 years, over two decades. And he's also an Olympic medalist, brought many laurels to India as a medalist in various categories, the Arjuna awardee as well. And you said I was reading one of your interviews and I was very struck by one thing that you said. And you said, when you excel as a sports star, then the laurels that you get, that the success that you get stays with you individually. Whereas when you step out into the public field and you succeed as a public leader, then the gains that you make are distributed to the citizens at large as well. I thought that was a fascinating point of view, because normally I'm very, you know, sort of personally not inclined to go into political life. Public life would be a little different, but you're in the political life because I have certain views of it, on it. And a lot of women over here share those views, like we had views on the media that it's a negative place. We have views on politics that it's not a great place for women to be in. But you put it very beautifully, which almost half motivated me to step there. Would you like to share a little about that, please?
The last part seems very exciting, actually. So truly, I mean, I've always felt I've had the blessing of the God to actually give me an opportunity to serve in different and gain different experiences. But I've always felt that I've been playing for India in whatever I did. So when I was in the army, I was donned the uniform of the military. I was playing for India. When I became a sportsman and I was representing the country, I was literally playing for the country. But now when I am in the politics, I truly believe that I would be playing for each and every Indian, specifically so in my own constituency, but when I represent a ministry to whichever area the ministry can reach out, and when I'm part of the Prime Minister's team, then everything that the government of India does is to reach out to people, so I'm literally playing for them. And I can actually sense that as compared to any other time, of course, when you are in the army, you're protecting everyone, you're the last line of defense, you are imbibed with such principles and spirit that you're ready to lay your life. That's what every person does who dons the uniform. But when you're playing for the country as well, you are bringing laurels to the nation and you represent the country in everything that you do. But when you truly speak about materialistically, how is an average Indian gaining by your actions, then it's much more when you play as a team in the government of India. It's not to say that anywhere when you do anything is any less. It's not to say that at all. But I was just trying to explain as to what my three roles have been till now. And in each one, I find myself playing for the country.
Thank you for that. I wanted to ask you a question about, do you think the role of government is overestimated, or we make too much of it, and we make too little of something that could be very valuable in the construction of a society, in the evolution of a society, is the role of a vibrant civil society? And do you think they can play equal half roles, or do you think there are certain things that one needs to overestimate the government for what it is, or do you think we need to place equal emphasis on a vibrant civil society, and what would be your guidance to the civil society members for that?
I think, Arbin, that's a wonderful question that you asked me. I think nothing can be more than what civil society does. Literally, nothing can be more than what an ordinary citizen, and especially when they come together as a society, when they are what they are capable of, nothing can be more than that. Government is just an enabler, actually, a facilitator. And that's what the Prime Minister meant when he said that he will endeavor to have maximum governance and minimum government. If we are infusing funds into economy, Government of India is one of the last boosters of the economy, the funds that it's putting into the economy for infrastructure and other things. But finally, it's basically to revive, to rejuvenate, to boost up each and every biz that probably all of you represent. Or when he talks about these things of Beti Bachao or Swachhta, what is he doing? He's just probably reaching out to each and every conscience of each and every Indian and to the society at large that you can do it. Really, that you yourself believe that is impossible is something that you can do it. Individually, when a Prime Minister picks up the broom and steps out and photographs are taken of it, it's not actually that he's going to clean the roads himself. It is that let there be pride in picking up the groom and cleaning the dirt which is all around us because it's created by us. So you are the most powerful people. You need to realize that you are most powerful. You are the people that select people who go into the government. So you are the ones who are the most powerful in each and every way. You are the people who provide jobs to the people of India. That's when he says that I need my micro, medium, small industries to really boost up, because they are the number, they are the people who actually provide the largest employment. So it's every time, it's you, Harbin. You need to step up and do what you deem fit to do for this country.
One more question that I would ask, which is a little off the turf, but since it's a women's forum and we are in India, I think I have to ask this, that in India we worship the divine feminine. So when we go to the temples, it is Durga, Saraswati, you know, it is the divine feminine, Ma Shakti, it's Mother Shakti. So it is the woman that we worship. And when it comes to attitudes and sensibilities, there is a lot of respect for the woman as a mother. What do you think we need to do as women so that this respect translates into real society as well, that women can be respected not just as mothers, but as wives, as sisters, as women?
I think it's already happening. The change is beginning to take place, and you can see it yourself in your families, around your families, in the whole country. If you feel the change is not happening, please go back to about 100 years ago, or let's not even go back 100 years, go back about 20 years ago and see the change in, see what was the status of women in rural areas or in urban areas. I'll tell you a difference, just as an example. So I had, in my constituency, I'm constantly thinking about engaging the youth by different formats. So we said, why not have a tournament where the entire constituency takes part as one. So I have about 362 village headquarters, about 2,000 villages. So I said, why not have a team, minimum a team from each village, and let's have a kabaddi competition in my constituency and really hype it up. So of course we had Star Sports come in as partners because they are doing kabaddi as well. And so it was really a very high level of competition. But the interesting part was, when I announced that we're going to have a kabaddi tournament, I didn't specify gender. But when the word went out, my team called up panicking. They said, sir, girls are calling saying that they want to participate in kabaddi. Now, you have to remember, this is rural India that I'm speaking. I'm not speaking about Delhi. I'm not speaking about Jaipur. I'm speaking about everything between Delhi and Jaipur. So when you travel on the highway, you have to see beyond the highway, beyond the dhabas, that those huts, the small huts, the kind of environment there. They said that they were panicking. They said their girls are calling that, can they... So I said, of course, allow them to participate. Then the next question was that we've given a dress code to the boys, shorts and t-shirts. What do we do with the girls? So I said, just keep quiet. Let them wear whatever they want. But the idea is to participate. You'll be surprised. I had 23 women kabaddi teams participate. I mean, I had 500 boys team. Of course, there's a big comparison difference. But I had 23 women kabaddi team. And they all came in shorts and t-shirts on their own. And I have videos and photographs for that. Now, this is rural India. And it's changing. So the change is beginning to happen. When I said right in the beginning, when I go and meet them, and I'm really grateful that I got a rural constituency as my constituency to nurture, because that's where the difference can be really seen and really needed. I see the aspirations in them. Girls, I have another example I'll give you. For about a couple of years, there was no recruitment, army recruitment in Delhi, in Jaipur district. The reason was that at one point of time when they held it, there were certain riots that happened because 45,000 people come to take part, only 600 are selected. So you can imagine those who get rejected can be very angry and destructive. So there were a few riots that took place. So they stopped holding army recruitment in Jaipur district. And I said, if I've been selected as the member of parliament from Jaipur district will have recruitment. It just cannot happen. So we organized it, and we organized it very well, of course. It is organized by the administration. But the interesting part here, we organized... For example, there is a pre-training for IAAS, there's pre-training for IIT. But in the villages, the youth did not know when they're going to be tested for recruitment in the army. Very basic thing, what is going to be the test? What is going to be the physical test and the academic test? So we created a pre-training for them. We organized pre-training for them. And organizing pre-training free of cost for 45,000 youth is a huge job. So we created 24 grounds in which voluntarily all those people who had retired from the army, the physical teachers of the schools, the volunteers, the various society people in the society, they took part and they organized it. So there was a sort of a atmosphere that every day in the morning, large number of youths would come to this ground, run around it. And I told some of the people who were well-to-do in those villages, I said, can you not give them a glass of milk and a banana after they run? They said, yes, of course we can do it. So all that was organized and there was a great atmosphere there. The women told me, the girls told me when I went to the constituency and they would all rush to me, says, why are you not organizing it for us? Why are you not taking us into the army? Now, the army recruitment is basically at the soldier level. It's for boys, it's for men. But you see, that's the sort of difference that's coming in already. So change is happening. The very fact that we all are sitting here and discussing, of course, I understand this is urban India, but I'm talking about rural India. So change is happening. Women have been playing a very important role from ages. Right? You take the kings, you go back to the kingdoms, they've been very actively involved in giving very important advice. Even to the extent of my own family, I started by saying that I couldn't have been what I've done had it not been for the support of my wife and my mother. I said it very openly. So women have been playing a very important role. It is just that their role has not been publicly acknowledged so far. And when the government of India... When the government of India says that we will have 33% reservation in police forces for women, it's a step towards that direction. When the Prime Minister says that on the 26th January in the Republic Day parade, I want to see the contingents being led by women, contingents of women. It doesn't necessarily mean that means the world has changed. What that means is change your behavior, because the country is changing by putting them right in the front. That's what it means. When the Prime Minister says, why don't we have fighter women pilots? And last year, we had 3 fighter women pilots join in. It doesn't mean that now everything's okay and we can go back to what it was. It means the change has begun at the highest level. So these are the changes which I mean that it's happening now. I'll give you another example. This is not true, not just limited to India. This is true worldwide that we don't acknowledge women. In the Olympics in 1996, in the sport of shooting, women and men competed in the same event because after all, it was the gun that was doing the work actually, right? You were just aiming and pressing the trigger, which didn't really need different levels of strength. So it was women and men competing in the same event in 1996 Olympics. The first time women beat the men and to the gold, and so they separated the events out. So you see, the point that I'm trying to make is just not limited to India. The Olympic Committee separated the women out and said, you shoot only 75 targets, that's good enough for you. The men will shoot 125, as if the women can't shoot.
You know, there was a time when we were speaking in the media about the loss of credibility, that we're losing trust in what the media is saying, and there needs to be a resurgence of tall leaders. And we were just talking about what Karthike and Raji have been doing in their respective channels. In the political spectrum, there's been in India, worldwide as well, a loss of credibility. I mean, I'm harking back to, let's say, Indian independence time, when we had tall leaders who were called statesmen. They were not called politicians, they were called statesmen. And there was this thing of looking up to them and saying, they're thought leaders. Whatever they are saying, you know, puts a direction. And then we went through a little dip for quite a long time where we started not listening to politicians. And in fact, we had a remark this morning as well of discounting and saying they don't walk the talk. They just talk and they don't walk it. We now see a revival of the statesmanship in the kind of leaders that the government is having, where there is accountability. where there's in the bureaucrat's office or the minister's office, there's even accountability to the point of, are you punctual enough? Are you coming to the office on time? So there's this whole resurgence. What is your, you know, do you think this is going to continue? It's a trend here to stay. Women are voting a lot more, and they're voting for this accountability. Any thoughts on this accountability? Is it here to stay, or is it going to slide back into what we've known as, you know, what politicians to be?
So, of course, there are good apples and bad apples. But then that can't be an excuse. Everything needs to be much better. I know Raj has had a great reputation. Karthik represents a great news channel. There are few very, very good, very authentic, very dependable journalists out there. You see, the whole aspect of commercialization coming into media is putting a lot of pressure on their TRPs, on the number of people who are watching their channels, based on which they're going to get their advertisements. And because of the urge to get more people to watch, there's a tendency by some to add a lot of masala and to take a little a biased line which could be more popular, or which could be which could stand out so that they are noticed. So this is the fight between the commercial aspect of media vis-a-vis the fourth pillar that we all call, which actually is able to make us all walk the right line. But I've had this conversation before. This is a threat both to politicians and now to media. Yes, there were times when politicians were statesmen and they would be icons for people, but things became very bad. And the Prime Minister has actually spoken about it, that we need to change this culture, this aspect. I've had this conversation where I've told some of the media friends of mine, I said, how often when you walk at the airport, has some child walked up to you or the parents brought their kid to you and said, meet so-and-so, he represents the Indian media. He is the one who you see in the channels, or he is the one who writes stories, and the child would like to shake your hands. It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen for politicians as well. Maybe for very, very few politicians, it'll certainly happen for the Prime Minister. He's a loved figure, absolutely. When I walk into the airports, kids walk up to me, the parents introduce them to me, of me as a sportsman, not me as a politician. And I'm a minister. So, but they want their kids to meet me because I've won an Olympic medal, or because I've been in the Indian Army and I've fought. Those are the attributes that parents want the child to know about me, right? So this is a challenge, and it's a growing challenge for both politicians and now for media as well, to remain absolutely true and to cut themselves off from the commercial aspect to the real aspect of presenting news. It is a challenge, and we all have to rise to it.
I'd like to share what you just said. When I was writing my first book, and I had just come back from Paris, you know, done my PhD, and was writing in a very academic style. So when I asked my mother to read it, she said, I didn't get anything. And then I realized I have to subject every communication to the test of the mother. So if a mother can understand it, then you've passed the test. So what you just reiterated over here, that are politicians going to be passing the test of the mother? Is a mother going to advise the child to go and shake the hands of the politician or educate the child about a certain leader? And even in the media, I think my someone in my family, she wouldn't let the, because the mothers control the remote control, no matter, they can have fights on it, let her children watch certain comedy channels because the humor over there was very adult humor, and she didn't want her children of 4 years and 6 years to be subjected to that kind of a thing. So I think we are looking at the return of the test of the mother. It's just a humble observation from what I have been listening to everybody, and that's the power of the woman. That's your power. Like Anurag is here with me, he's partnering with the Women Economic Forum from the business world. Anurag, would you like to have a question, please?
I can't, you know, I have conversations with all three of them privately, and I can only say that I first met him at a CNN IBN event. My friend Dilip introduced me, you'd won the Sports Person of the Year. It is a couple of years after your Olympic medal. That's when I first met you, and in the last 2 years, I have had the opportunity to interact with you more. I can only tell you, and I am not a diplomatic person, right? And, you know, I get into trouble because of that, right? I call some friends, spade a spade, Amit, you know. But I can tell you that when you have leaders like that, who literally are conscientious, who are also sports people, and sports is real achievement in my view. Either you win or you lose. There's no, you know, you can't give five reasons to your board why you didn't do your numbers, right? Like we do. So I think when we have leaders like Shri Rajyavardhan Rathore, Colonel Rathore, I think we are in safe hands. We had a conversation, Suparna is there, she puts together our news broadcast awards. We missed you this year because of the election, but I hope we'll have you at where you'll have audience with Mr. Sharma and hopefully Mr. Nayak and everyone. So I don't want to ask a question, but I want to say that the INB ministry is conscious of the fact that the digital media is important and it needs, and overall media needs to self-regulate. So the INB ministry has been an enabler and a catalyst, but not being somebody who's really kind of weighing down on the neck of media owners or journalists. So in that sense, I think the INB minister and the government should be applauded. Normally, governments are always trying to control. That is always there. And I mean, but I think please give the minister a big round of applause. He's always punctual. He always keeps his. He's very, very courteous. And, you know, he's a very real person. So he's not a phony person. So I can just say that, sir.
No, on the subject that Anurag has just mentioned, actually, you need to see my Twitter account to see what kind of beating I get from the general public, who's constantly wanting me to take action against the media. Now, come on. I mean, there's a limit. We cannot. This is a free society where everybody is free to say whatever they want. And the best thing is to regulate. The media needs to regulate themselves. So we've never taken any, really, really been very restrictive in taking steps against the media. But I get a solid beating on from the people on the Twitter.
So I think you are wise. So you're, and clearly you're letting us be who we are, sir. And hopefully we are more responsible and we are conscious of the responsibility we have and the trust you have and the people have. So I think you know, we value that, and I hope, you know. Also, Twitter is, I mean, it's like a choraha. Wah, koi kuch bhi bol deta hai, you know. Matlab kuch bhi bol deta hai, you know. They don't know anything about anything, but they'll give you a sermon on something, you know, which they haven't even experienced in their life. So I don't think you should take Twitter that seriously, sir.
No, absolutely. In fact, it was very interesting. I thought that probably it's only in India. You always feel that yahi par hi hota hoga is tarah se. You felt it's only in India. Then I read the Times magazine, and one of the cover page was anger on social media. It's a worldwide phenomena. So I said, all right, we are not that bad then.
But it's very interesting. Worldwide, the statistics are that we have more women on social media than men. So one would like to see more compassion out there. Or do you think the anger gets more visibility and notice, and the more normal, regular conversation gets drowned out by that? I don't know. It's just a question, because I wonder. And the number of women on social media is only going to increase. But that brings me to one question of safety of women on social media. There's a big problem of cyber stalking on social media. So I don't know if the INB ministry is doing something on regulating social media, or not regulating, but having a place where a woman could go and address her issues. Because right now, it's a big question mark. If I'm being cyber stalked, if I go to the police and say I want an FIR registered, they say, against who? There's nobody. It's an anonymous account of, let's say, Facebook. We're going to have the Facebook head over here, so maybe we'll ask him here later tomorrow. But is there something from the ministry that's coming?
I love this part. Because when I'm given a post a question like this, I simply say, this is not my ministry. It's the information, it comes under the Information Technology Ministry. And Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad is the minister there. But that was on the lighter side. This is a new world. This social media, the ability to, let me relate it to this. Many, many years ago, when any other country needed to do a propaganda warfare, an information warfare, they had to fly planes over to drop leaflets, or they had to set up a clandestine radio to broadcast. Now, they don't have to do anything like that. Sitting wherever they are, they can actually get into your bedrooms or wherever you are through your social media accounts. No one knows all this information, whether hyped up information, whether false information is coming from real sources or fake sources, whether it's being orchestrated or it's really there. So this is a new world to all of us. And believe me, most of the people in various governments across the world have the same question in their mind. What do we do with this? I think the solution only lies in each individual, all of us put together. I say this to the young people actually when I go to the schools, but I'll repeat it here. I said, if you love your country, you can be a soldier wherever you are. You need not wear a uniform to be a soldier for this country. And you don't need not go to the borders now, because the enemy can actually strike in your homes. All you have to do is be aware and not forward any malicious content or anything that you are not aware of, and actually be a soldier to prevent such forwarding of such information. So all this is required now. It's a new world. We really don't know the solutions.
Thank you so much, Honorable Minister. You can be a soldier wherever you are. With that, we come to the conclusion of the interview with the Honorable Minister, and I will ask Mansi to lead us forward, please.
Please don't go anywhere, because we're going to seamlessly take this into our formal inaugural, and I welcome you on this momentous afternoon once again to the Women Economic Forum 2017. We're being joined by our guest of honor this afternoon, Ms. Alenka Smerkel, Minister for Development, Strategic Projects and Cohesion, Slovenia. Please give her a warm round of applause. We have preponed this session, so if the other speakers are here, I'd like to invite them on the stage. So I will announce your names, and if you're here, please do join us. So you know who you are, so if the speakers of the next session are here, please do come up. As our chief guest for the afternoon, I request Honorable Minister to kindly say a few words to declare the forum open once again. Thank you.
Honorable Minister, you have to declare the forum formally open. We've been warming up since yesterday night.
So if I have the permission of all the ladies here, do I? So I declare the event open.
Thank you, sir. Could I now request our guest of honor, Madam Alenka, to kindly share her wisdom and journey with us, please, today.
I'd like to go to the podium.
Thank you. Well, dear ladies, dear gentlemen, a fewer gentlemen, more ladies, but still. First of all, I would like, is it okay? Yeah, okay. So I start. First of all, I would really like to thank the organizers for bringing here so many inspirational, inspiring leaders from all over the world. As her dean said this morning, we put a lot of faith and trust in each other. And as a matter of fact, you have already put a lot of faith and trust in me even before you hear what I say. I will say a little bit more at 3 o'clock this afternoon, so you're all welcome to that plenary session as well. But let me say a few words here. I come from Slovenia. Please, can you raise your hand if you really know where Slovenia is? No, you ladies don't count because you came with me, but the others, well, perhaps it's important that I say a few words and allow me to say a few more words on our country, the country where I come from. Slovenia, this is the only country in the world with the word love in its name. So we sometimes say Slovenia. Slovenia is also one of the smallest countries within European Union already. Can you imagine the world? With a population of 2 million people, we can only be compared to a small suburb of New Delhi, I guess, but really a small one. I don't know whether you have a 2 million suburb in Delhi. But even we are small in a lot of things, we are big. Actually, we are also world class in many areas. Look at protection of waters. Namely, we are one of the very, very few countries that put the right to clean water even in its constitution. We did that last year. Also, protection of environment. 60% of our country is covered by forest, so we are a very, very green country. We invest a lot in education. We are one of the safest countries in the world. And Slovenia is also a country where gender equality plays extremely important role. Look at our government, the composition of the today's government of Slovenia. It's completely gender balanced. We are 50-50, 16 ministers, and I am one of the 8 female ministers. But even if not even in my wildest dreams I thought I would become a politician or even a minister, I am now truly, truly passionate about it. Because this is the only position in the country where in reality you can make a change and you can make a change happen. But believe me, this is not easy, even if the government is gender balanced. Bringing silos down is never an easy task, and this is what I try to do. But imagine how my colleagues in government look at me when I start speaking about how happiness is important. I know, because it's true for Slovenia as well, that a lot of leaders, politicians, companies do not see happiness of people as their responsibility. But as Prime Minister of Bhutan is saying in all his public, or not just public, but it's his personal mission, Mr. Topgai says, there is no reason for the government to exist if they are not able to make their people happy. I truly believe in what he's saying, and that this is why I'm so excited that happiness has its place also in our Vision 2050. And I will be saying a few more words about the project, the process, and where we stand with the vision and strategy later today at 3 o'clock. So welcome to be there. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words of wisdom. In the same breath, don't sit down, ladies. We'd like to honor the minister with a token of our appreciation with the award for Woman of the Decade in Public Life.
We're going to now begin with the award ceremony. So if any of the other awardees for this session are here, I do request you to come on stage now, please. Our minister needs to leave. He has a country to run. So I now request our minister here to kindly give away the award to Karthikeya Sharma, the founder and promoter of ITV Network, as the business leader of the decade. Mr. Raj Nayak to come and accept his award for the leaders of the decade in media and television. Our next awardee is William N. Bissell, the MD of Fab India, as the business leader of the decade. Jay, are you here? Our next awardee.
You know, I'll start a clapping company and bring them, but that's next time. Today, please clap for the winners. Can you clap louder? Suparna.
Our next awardee, Woman of the Decade in Community Leadership and Service, is Leela Punavala. Please put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Jennifer Riria, Agatha Amata, yes, we have you. She's the MD and CEO Inside Out Media, all the way from Nigeria. Please put your hands together as she gets the award for Woman of the Decade in Innovation and Leadership. Welcome Dr. Jennifer Riria from Kenya, Women Holding Kenya, as she receives the award for Woman of the Decade in Innovation and Leadership. I call upon Jyoti Deshpande, CEO, Eros International. And she accepts the award as the Woman of the Decade in Innovation and Leadership. Ms. Pina, do we have you? Marita from Lithuania, are you here? Thank you.
Radha Kapoor Khanna? Do we have you with us? Not yet. Nishi Vasudeva? Please do come up. She's the ex-chairman and managing director of Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited, and she accepts the award for Woman of the Decade in Innovation and Leadership. Ladies and gentlemen. And welcoming Maria Pavilioni from Lithuania. She is the former MP and activist and one of the most well-known LGBT rights activists in Lithuania and the chairman of ad hoc group of CIMAS members for equality. Despina here from Cyprus? Is she here? Okay. We'll have a quick picture.
Some of the awardees who were not able to make it today, they have sent their representatives. So I will request on behalf of Isabel Noboa, Dr. Patricia, to kindly come up and accept the award on Isabella's behalf.
I think it's the ambassador of Ecuador who's present here to accept the award on Isabel's behalf. I would like to welcome Excellency on stage. By Vijay Shekhar Sharma, the owner of what everybody knows is the star of the startup system, the owner of Paytm. He's here with us today. Of course, we'll have the privilege of listening to him, and we'd like to give him the award of Entrepreneur of the Decade.
On behalf of Fernanda Vicente, we have Ms. Marisol Carranz, the Deputy Chief of Mission of Embassy of Chile. Representing Gina Reinhardt, we have Melanie Camp and Georgina Camp. We have you, ladies. Welcome. Please come on stage.
award for Fernanda Vincent from Chile as well, please. Yes. We've got the Deputy Chief of Mission here to get the award on Fernanda's behalf.
And by Dr. R. Rengalakshmi, on behalf of Dr. M. S. Swaminathan, to accept the award on his behalf. The Director of the Gender Department, M. S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, Chennai. On behalf of Betty DeVita, we have Sukanya Mishra, the Senior Vice President. Do we have you here, Sukanya? Yes, we do. The Senior Vice President and Group Head, South Asia, Advisor, COE, and MasterCard Advisors. On behalf of Shikha Sharma from Axis Bank. Do we have Ms. Ragini Chopra on behalf of Naresh Goyal? We have Shikha Sharma representing the MD and CEO of Axis Bank, Ms. Shikha Sharma. Welcome Ms. Ragini Chopra on behalf of Naresh Goyal, founder and chairman of Jet Airways, as the business leader of the decade. Please put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen. There's a special award for Mr. Ratan Tata. He sent his apologies for not being able to make it today, but he does accept the award as the legendary leader in public life and nation building at the WEF. Thank you. We will now come together for a group photograph, please. And we will hear the personal stories of everyone. Betty Young and Agatha Amata, please do accept your awards in hindsight. joined by Despina Theodisou as the Woman of the Decade in Innovation and Leadership. Please come. Also call upon Radha Kapoor Khanna to accept her award as the Woman of the Decade in Family Business. She's the founder and executive director of Indian School of Design and Innovation. And Sonia Paul is accepting the award on her behalf. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I request you to take a seat. Don't go anywhere. Because now we begin with actually a very special bit of our session. Awardees, please find a seat right behind you.
We will thank the Honorable Minister for joining us for the award ceremony. He has to leave. A round of applause for the Honorable Minister, please, to spare his time and join us. I request the awardees to please stay on stage, continue here. And Mansi, I will pass it on to you to conduct the event. Nishiji.
We will now be inspired by the personal journeys and thoughts of some of the most powerful success stories that we have the honor of having amongst us this afternoon. I'd just like to let you know that we'll hear each speaker for 4.5 minutes. At 4 minutes, a sweet little buzzer may go off, and that'll let you know that you have 30 more seconds remaining.
We'd request everybody to stay in the room. We're going to have remarks by the awardees here.
Sir, can we request you back, please? We do have a little memento for our minister. He's looking at his watch, so we've got to be quick with this. Harbin, I request you to present the Honorable Minister with the award as the Leader of the Decade in Public Life. Please put your hands together for an extremely inspiring. At the onset. Surely there's a lot of excitement, but there's more to come. At the onset, I'd like to call upon Karthikeya Sharma, founder and promoter, ITV Network, to kindly share his life experience with us.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and particularly ladies. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. I had the opportunity to speak to some of you earlier on. I think it's a great platform. WEF is doing a fantastic job in bringing people together for a cause which is very relevant and very important to us. I represent ITV Network. We are one of the fastest growing media companies in the country. We reach out to about 120 million people on a daily basis. And I would love to share some of my experiences with you as in that journey which started almost 10 years ago. You know, I think while we always try and get and try and achieve our targets, what we set out when we start a journey, we tend to lose sight of what is it that we're doing and why are we doing it and where do we want to get with what we had planned. I remember as a student while I was studying, and I was in England for about 9 years. I did my schooling at Oxford. I did my undergrad there and my master's at King's College. And I could never think or perhaps know that I would actually come and be a part of the media industry. And since it was one of the furthest things to my mind at that point of time, and I did not have clarity in terms of this is how life would evolve and I would move towards it, I think what really changed and motivated me to come into the field of media was to actually bring in equality, the opportunity to bring in a platform for people to be equitable, for people to be able to voice their opinions. And while I was in England, it gave me an opportunity to see how media evolved in India from abstract. And that is something which was truly remarkable because it gave me a perspective on how things were changing in India. India was really changing after the liberalization in 1990s, and the entire industry was changing. The way people communicated, the way people saw information, and the way it sort of evolved in the last 10 years was very interesting period for India because that's when the markets opened up. And you know, to my surprise, when I started my media company, frankly, in the first instance, for the first couple of years, it wasn't terribly successful. And I think the main thing that I learned from that entire episode was learn how to learn. And that went a long way for me. And I think that is the single most important experience that I want to share with everyone. I think the ability to learn is something that is with us from the time we start learning till our last breath. And that's what makes us truly different and truly helps us change and evolve as a human being, as a person, as an entity, as an idea, as a thought process. And I think if we can realize the power of learning from our immediate surroundings, from people, our peers, from people we work with, from the people we work under, for people whose stewardship we work under, I think that is the greatest ability that sets us apart from our, you know, from things that we don't do in a normal life. I think that failure and the ability to learn really motivated me to excel and do better in my field of work. And fortunately, I'm glad to say we are now one of the top five media companies in the country. We've come a long way from that learning process, that learning curve. And I think we've really been able to come out of the toughest and the most difficult industries in the news and media space. And I'm very glad to share this experience with you. And I would really urge all of you not to stop learning. And I think that is something which always stays with us. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Karthikeya. I now invite Vijay Shekhar Sharma, founder Paytm, to share his entrepreneurial journey with us and inspire us.
Hi. I see, first of all, I mean, I have not been in an event in India where so many incredible and so many international ladies would be there, and the kind of the energy that, ma'am, you've been able to put in this room, we should first put a cheer for the host here in the evening, in the afternoon today. As an entrepreneur, I totally believe that we live through the life like a woman lives through the life of creation, because the God has granted the power to create by default in a lady and a woman like we are talking today. And some of us as entrepreneurs also try to create something which is against every odd and a probability. And just like what you will nurture your baby and a kid into a grown up and then you will expect it to become an independent, that's exactly like how an entrepreneur believes and behaves, like that they want to give birth to an entity and then they want to let that entity grow, cajole, take care, and then over the period grow and become a pride of them. So I think somewhere the womanhood is more or less very similar to the entrepreneurhood that I personally believe in. So the amount of skills and the capabilities as a woman you have, you're the more prone to become an entrepreneur and capable to become than a man is. Because as a man, we are very ruthless and harsh by default as a serotonin or levels of hormones that we carry. But at the same point of time, as a woman, you have a lot more capability to harmonize and hold together and take it together forward. While as a man, we need to learn a lot more. So, I mean, today I reflect upon the capabilities as a woman you offer, as an entrepreneur that we get to learn from each one of you is quite humbling. I really appreciate and admire this conference and thank you for the honor that has been bestowed upon. And I look forward to learn and build something worthwhile from this country. Thank you so much for having me here. Thank you, really appreciate it.
It works. I just wanted to share, I was so moved by Vijay when I heard him on Anurag's event, actually, where he shared that there was a point in time, as women entrepreneurs, we all struggle with getting financing, right, for our companies. And there was such a moving story that Vijay shared that just less than a decade ago, maybe, right, he had to sell 40% of his company for just getting an 8 lakhs loan. And I was so moved with that. And so Vijay has seen, he's been through a great period of struggle. He's very grounded. And his message to all the women is, if I can, everyone can. So Vijay, today you are bringing a sort of revolution with the cashless payment system in the country. If there's any one message you want to give to women entrepreneurs who are struggling with finance, who are struggling with their dreams, if there's one message I do want you to share here today, because it's very special, I know where it comes from.
Thank you. So, every one of us, I just want to tell you, every one of us has less money and resources than we wish. It doesn't matter you talk to a billionaire, millionaire, or a person with a couple of $100 in the pocket right now. Each one of us is short of resources. It doesn't matter what benchmark that you're talking about. In a way, if you want to measure yourself at what hierarchy you are in the life and a social stature, you should just think about what is the amount that takes your night sleep. For example, like, is it about if I get tens of thousands of dollars, or is it about I get a couple of $1 million and my life will change? And incidentally, just remember this, the money continues to remain that elusive carrot in front of us, which continues to move forward as soon as we continue to achieve a milestone. And when it comes about the money and resources available to each one of us, and I say to my team, and I say to each one of you in this room, money is not the final answer to any problem in the world, whatever the problem is. Money is not the final need of the thing that you want to do it. It is your resolve, it is your commitment, it is your undying spirit to continue to do it that will polarize others with the resources to part with you or partner with you. So remember, money is never the final or ultimate reason that you will stop. You will stop because on that day you stop believing in it. You will stop because you believe that the money has become superior than the purpose that you're belonging to. And I repeat it again, if you ever needed money and your purpose and the work that you're doing is something that you believe in, number of people will come on the way. Number of people will come on the way. God comes in different shapes and sizes and shows up in different places than we can imagine. And that's exactly what somebody will knock at your door or will become your partner to become part of the story that will become the journey that you want to be part of it. And finally, one line. I learned one thing, that God tries to test us all. it tries to test us by giving some greed to us or tries to give us through the exit route on the way. They try to find out whether you are going to exit up this curve that comes or will you throw out of the curve that is coming or go out of the road. But this is exactly the moment. If you do not leave any alternate whatsoever, if you close every exit door out there, and if you believe that there is only one way to go, that is the way on your path of vision and the dream that you carry, I swear on God, you will go there and reach there, because there is only one way to live through a dream, that is called T-I-N-A. There is no other alternate at all. Tina factor, that's it. So on the vision, on the purpose, on the mission, and that is the only way. Won't come, money won't make it. Money has never made people rich. And the amount of impact that you guys will bring in this world without money will be many times more than the people with the money has ever bought in this world any which ways. Yes. I just want you to know this. Money has never been the part of history books. All your work, all your purpose, all your mission and the impact and the change that you bring is a part of the history books. So more power to each one of you in this room. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vijay. I have heard him, so I wanted to make sure that we hear that passion which comes from his gut, which comes from his experience. So thank you, Vijay, for sharing that. Mansi.
Thank you, Harbin. Thank you, Vijay, for that peep into ground reality. And it's really quite inspiring. Thank you very much. I'd like to next invite Mr. Raj Nayak, the CEO of Color Television and Rishte.
He'll speak later on another session. So
okay,
we
perfect.
Can continue.
Then could I invite Mr. William N. Bissell, the Managing Director of Fab India, to share his journey with us.
Hello, everybody. I wanted to just thank Harbin for putting this amazing event together. I've been hearing about it over the years, and I'm honored to be here today. And honored to see what you have actually accomplished and how much talent that you brought together under one roof. Madam Minister, I feel a bit like an imposter talking at a women's event here, but since Harbin has been kind enough to invite a few men, it's very nice of her to do that. One of the interesting things about the company I run is that most of the people who work with us, most of our partners, are actually enterprises that are either run by women or in which we have a large number of women who work. And it's been an interesting journey to build a brand in a country like India, which is our brand sells clothes mostly to women. And we have, we're a 55-year-old brand that has been in the retail industry in India. We have stores all over Delhi. For those of you who haven't visited, I'd recommend a visit while you're here. But one of the things that we've actually pioneered in is we've understood how at the grassroots, really helping women earn an income is possibly the most important economic activity individuals and governments can do. And it's been an amazing journey to see. We work in about 220 of India's 611 districts. And we see a lot of how women have to struggle with their lives. In many parts of rural India, women are the sole breadwinners in the community. They've also, in many cases, have had to be single parents because their husbands have gone off to the cities in search of work. And it's an amazing struggle to see how they've pulled together this and managed through these times of economic hardship. One of the interesting things, there are a number of organizations in this country that have been founded by women, like the Self-Employed Women's Association, which has over 2 million members. That have done amazing work in women's empowerment and employment. And I urge, you know, since you represent such a vast variety of talent across the world, I mean, you're women from across the world who've come here to join and create something in solidarity, I think it would be very important to recognize in every country where women have taken the leadership role and have built something truly transformative. I think that we've all seen the 20th century with its many wars and its many conflicts has been a century where the world was run by men. I'm hoping that in the 21st century, we men can take a rest, and maybe the world can be run by women, and I think the 21st century will be very different from the 20th century. Thank you very much.
I just wanted to share with everybody, there are two men I deeply admire. One is a film director. His name is Sanjay Leela Bhansali. And the other is William Nanda Bissell. One big reason is that their middle name is from their mother, which is very beautiful. So thank you very much, William. You didn't do it for us, I know, but it means a lot to us. Thank you.
Beautiful. Could I request Lila Punavala, the founder of Lila Punavala Foundation, to come and say a few words about her journey?
Hello, good afternoon. I'm sure all of you are wanting to go for lunch. So I will be very, very brief because I have another session afterwards. I'm told that I'm the founder director of Lila Punavala Foundation, but this came much, much later in my life. I started my life as a refugee when I came into this country way back in 1947. And coming up the way we did, it was worth the journey. And I became the first woman mechanical engineer. And I think I became an engineer where most of you might not have been born also. It was in 1967, way back, when engineering itself was not considered to be a woman's domain. And I wanted to do not only engineering, but a mechanical engineering, which was down to shop floor working. But I enjoyed that journey, and I joined a company, which was a multinational Swedish company, Alfa Laval, as an apprentice, and I'm very pleased to tell you that I was given the opportunity to work and to prove myself and rose from an apprentice to become the CMD of that company within less than 20 years. So it's been a nice journey, and when I was growing up to be an engineer, as I told you, I came in as a refugee, and I definitely needed help, financial help, to go through this education. And I suppose behind in my mind must always have been a point that somebody helped me to make it. So if I have the possibility, I should also do something for the society. And I suppose it must be this that made me want to start this foundation, which I started 22 years ago. I started the foundation supporting 20 girls for post-graduation because I didn't get a chance to do post-graduation. I had to start to work because we needed the money. So I started with 20 girls in 1996, and I'm very happy to tell you that last year we gave 1,360 girls scholarships. Today I work with 19 schools. And I've got undergraduate program, I've got post-graduation program, and I've got totally 6,000 girls in my family. And this has been much more rewarding than the job that I did as managing director. Because that was a professional job, this too is professional, but this gives you the joy of seeing happiness in others' eyes and in their life. It's lovely to be called by the girls' mom. They call me mom because, I mean, they're so young, they're so small. They call me mom and they call my husband dad. And it's a beautiful big family. It's not about giving them money alone. It's mentoring them, guiding them, trying to make them make their life. And that is what gives you joy. When I get a phone call and a girl tells me, mom, you know, I got placed and I started with a package of 6 lakhs of rupees. That brings joy to me. And that joy cannot be, explain, it is to be felt. The joy of giving is to be felt and not talked about. And I think all women, not only women, men and women, should try to do whatever little you can in your life for somebody else to make their life better, to bring joy and happiness into their life. And for women, I would like to say that there's no end to us being able to achieve what we want to achieve. Just have confidence in yourself. Have the will that I want to do it, not I have to do it. If you have to do it, it'll never work. Get up in the morning and say, I want to do this and I will do it. And you will do it. With these few words, I once again thank Harbin for persuading me to come to Delhi. When she phoned me up, I told her, is it really worth for me to come all the way for a day in Pune, from Pune here? She said, Leela, please come. I tell you, it's going to be a beautiful function. And I think you didn't describe it too well. It is much better than what she said. I never expected so many international people here, so many other colleagues from our own country, to meet them, to see them, and it's so very well organized. Congratulations to you, Harbin. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Leela ji. Please attend her masterclass today evening at 4:45 p.m. and it's very provocatively titled, Women Should Not Be Martyrs. Thank you, Leela ji.
Thank you. I invite Dr. Jennifer Riria, all the way from Kenya. She is the group CEO of Kenya Women Holding, to kindly share her life and times with us.
My sister, Dr. Aurora, women leaders of the world, I'm humbled tonight, this afternoon. I'm really humbled to stand here and receive an award. It's not about me. 27 years ago, young, bold, and careless, I left a very responsible job with the UN and joined to lead the women. The dream was that every woman in Kenya will wake up one day and she is able to put bread on the table for her children. Born out of experience from a very poor background, I needed women not to be beaten anymore. I needed a woman to say, I will go to hospital and she'll be able to get to the doctor. I needed a woman to say, I'm paying school fees for my daughter, and they were able to do it. I began Kenya Women Holding, which is now the largest microfinance bank working through women for families in Africa, south of the Sahara. I began with minus $2 million in uncollectible debts. I began in an environment that the banks said women should, Jennifer, do you want women with their baskets on their backs to crowd my counters? And I will tell you, ladies and gentlemen, today we are looking at an institution that operates in 45 counties out of 47. We began with minus $2 million in uncollectible debts. You are looking at an institution that has $4 billion behind our back. Banks are running looking for women because from reducing them to non-entities, they now know women are bankable, they are credible, and they hold the economies in their hands. Where would you be in an economy without women? We began with providing $3 for a loan for a woman. Today in this audience, I have Lucy, who is a manufacturer and who is a farmer. And she's here with us today for testimony. You can talk to her. On the education side, we have Professor here, Onguno, who is also a mentee who began with us. We work with women. We have learned it is important to listen to the women, innovate with them, getting them at the center of what is important to them. It is not about us. It's about what we will assist them to do for themselves and their families. It is not about us. It's about getting every woman in the space, as the minister said, where a woman can be a soldier. It is about women transforming the way the world works for them and their families. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really humbled.
Beautiful.
beautifully humbling and powerful, powerful words. Thank you so much. I do invite Agatha Amata, the MD and CEO of Inside Out Media from Nigeria, to inspire us, please.
I wanted to just add that there are two media companies owned by women in Nigeria, and Agatha Amata owns one of them. Agatha.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Habeen. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Agatha Amata. I am 48 years old. A proud mother, that's my first job, to two wonderful children. My son is 24 and my daughter is 19. And loads of adopted children. I started a TV talk show 20 years ago when it was not fashionable for women to come out and talk about problems. When religion was used as a guise for pedophilia, when widowhood practices against women were not talked about and were accepted as culture, I got into a lot of trouble at the time. I was very young, and they thought, who's this small girl who's challenging the status quo? But I kept with it. I started my recording in a little classroom. It had tables, it was a talk show, and nobody was doing anything like that at the time. In fact, it was very difficult to get people to come out and speak about their problems. I had to call topics the opposite of what I wanted to bring out. So if I wanted to talk about domestic violence, I would say, why would you challenge a man? Or the man is always right. And when I got everybody sitting down, then I start to ask the real questions. And so I did that for a couple of years. I got into trouble. And I found out that as far as Nigeria is concerned, and this is true of a lot of countries in Africa and maybe Asia as well, women and young people were the most vulnerable group. And I found out I was always dealing with issues that had to do with these two people. And so I started an NGO. I'm proud to say that as at last year, we partner with several NGOs. Our special focus is on widows and widowhood practices. Last year, December, we had about 3,500 widows as part of the group, where at the end of the year, we're able to give them something. And we also try to help them empower themselves. We sponsor widows' children to schools. A lot of the time, what they really want is vocational training so they can take care of themselves. And we've been able to do that in conjunction with other widows, with other NGOs. We've partnered with a lot of both governmental and non-governmental organizations on issues that have to do with domestic violence. If I tell you some of the things I've seen, a situation where a man sets his wife on fire and locks her up in a room and assumes she's dead, and we had to try to raise money for her so that she can be sent abroad for a total skin graft. A situation where a boyfriend who's a police officer shoots his wife to be in the face and half her face is gone because she dared to challenge him. It's endless. And you just wonder how and what you can do. You're so small and the problems are so big. But I always say this, it's my personal mantra. A life that cannot touch any other life is a wasted life. So if it is one step, whatever you do, if whatever little thing you can do, do it. You don't have to touch everybody. Just touch one person positively, and you would have done your bit for humanity. And so even as I, incidentally, this is my 20th year on TV. When I had done this for 10 years, I put a TV and a radio channel. I put two names up. I didn't know how I was going to get the funding. I didn't know where it was going to come from. I said, Agatha, you're going to own a radio channel, a radio station and a TV channel. It was a lot of work. Focus, persistence, perseverance, and God. And today, I have a staff of over 120. I have my own TV channel. and I have my own radio station, and I didn't get a loan from the bank. So yes, it can be done. Thank you very much for inviting me, and God bless you all.
Thank you, Agatha, for showing us. Yes, it can be. Yes, we can do it. Thank you. I'd like to invite on stage Radha Kapoor Khanna. She's the founder and executive director of the Indian School of Design and Innovation. Could you please come on stage, Radha? Please join us. Harbin, while you're here, can I get you to please present the award to Radha? As the woman of the decade in leadership, please put your hands together. Yes, Radha, can I invite you now, please, to share your journey with us? Thank you.
Thank you, Harbin, for this bestowing me with this great honor. It's great to be here among so many women and so many inspiring women. Well, dating back to when I actually graduated from college, I actually studied design and management. And when I returned back to India in 2009, I felt there was a great need for to provide a good education ecosystem here in India. And I actually really owe it to my father, who didn't let me sort of compromise on my, talent. And I think recognizing my talent and sort of taking on design and creativity, my passion as a career option. We're three girls, but I think he really pushed us and brought us up as sons and to think more business-like. So when I returned back, I knew that design could be used as a powerful tool, and how can we sort of bring about that change, here in India. So I set out to start our own design school here, and of course the obvious choice of design partner was my alma mater, the Parsons School of Design from New York. I think it was just serendipity, and we were like lucky enough to have them partner with us here in India. But I was very sure that I wanted to sort of not create just a knowledge center, but also a startup ecosystem for the Indian youth. I think there was a whole paradigm shift of career choices, amongst my peer group. And also, I think, how do we sort of make students now more industry ready? And when I was looking at the reports, the unemployment rate was so high, it was almost 80%. So I felt there was a great need to create the right skill sets and make our students today job ready. So we sort of set out to partner with the industry to sort of create the right skill sets, for 2020. So that's how we sort of put together the school and also started an accelerator with Microsoft Venture to sort of help launch further startups and provide them with the right resources, here in India. So an investment philosophy kind of revolves around DICE, which I like to term, which means design, innovation, creativity-led entrepreneurship. So that really is the focus of all our investments, and of course education being one of the closest ones to my heart. We've also invested in a co-working space, which is again, for the shared economy. We look at sort of giving out spaces for startups, for SMEs, wherein we provide the right sort of resources, community engagement, and networking platform for startups. So basically looking at this whole startup ecosystem, I think which is the right time for India. So I think it's great to receive this honor. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Radha. So that's what leadership looks like in its youngest and most dynamic shape and form. Thank you. I now request and invite Despina Theodiso, the Managing Director of Tototheo Maritime Group, Cyprus, to share her personal and professional experiences with us.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, what an incredible honor to receive this award, and what a humbling experience to be among such amazing, incredible women from all over the world. First and foremost, I wish to thank Dr. Harbin Arora. My dearest Harbin, thank you for your faith in me and for this award, and congratulations on an excellent event. I come from a highly competitive industry and a male-dominated industry, shipping. We are one of these industries where you go to a conference and you walk into the room and 90% of the participants are men, very much unlike today. And yet, I see or talk to strong women on a mission to succeed on an everyday basis. You know, I often get asked what it takes to be successful. There is no recipe. Not everything works for everyone. But from my experience, I can sum it up in a few points. Be passionate for what you do. We use this word passion a lot, but it's, I think, the most important ingredient. The best road to success is doing something that you love and you're truly committed to. If you're passionate about your job, then you will be self-motivated, more creative, work harder, and have greater chance at success. Accept other people's help, whether this is at work or at home. There is a term in sociology, the superwoman syndrome. That is the woman who works hard to manage multiple roles of a worker, a homemaker, a volunteer, a student, or other such time-intensive occupations. My point is, if you want to succeed at work, you need to have support. You do not have to do everything yourself. Focus on the big picture, do not micromanage. It needs quite a lot of effort to hang up your cape and accept you're not a superwoman, but once you do, things will become better. My advice is trust people, delegate, empower them. You will see in the end that this is a very gratifying feeling. Very relevant to this point is building a support system at home, especially if you're married and have children. You need to feel that your children are safe when you're away at work and they are having a good time. Be a team with your other half. My husband and I, who's here today, apart from spouses and business partners, we're each other's biggest supporter. We could not make it happen any other way. Have a strategy and focus. Set your mission. If you want to succeed in any business, have a plan. Focus on your plan. It takes a great deal of determination. Do not be discouraged or deterred by obstacles, because there will be many along the way. Learn to adapt. Revise your strategy if needed, and be flexible. Accept that you have full responsibility for your own future, and you're the only one that can make success happen. Take risks. If you want to be successful, you need to get out of your comfort zone. Make decisions that you think are bigger than you. It is natural to be afraid. What if I'm not good enough? What if I fail? What will my colleagues think of me? Or even worse, what will my boss think of me? All are valid questions. If you're taking away one thing from this speech, please let it be this. It is okay to be afraid, but get over it and do what you want to do anyway. I cannot even tell you how many times I have felt totally scared. What I can tell you is that the times I overcame the fear were probably the highlights of my career so far. Be ambitious. When a woman is ambitious, she's always judged. She's too bossy, she's abrasive, she comes across too strong. Somehow though, if a man is ambitious, then he's a leader, he's strong, and he's a role model. Here's the deal. Being ambitious will get you where you want to go. It will make you push boundaries and reach your goals. It will make you want to progress and grow as a person and a professional. And don't forget, big results require big ambitions. The bottom line, it does not matter what my advice is or what I think. It is, what is important is your own ethics, your ambitions, and your desire to succeed. Women, well, we have a lot going for us. We can be whoever we want and do whatever we set our mind on. Be passionate, be inspiring, be generous, be a good listener, be resourceful, be resilient, see the glass half full, multitask, adapt, and dream big and go for it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Despina. I wanted to personally welcome Socrates, who's here with Despina, a true partner in every way. And I wanted to share a very sweet anecdote. We call it sweet because we don't see men doing it. We see women doing it every day. But it was very wonderful that you shared that you took your three-month-old baby to the board meeting with you. And all the men were looking at him as if, what is he doing? And after half an hour, they sort of calmed down and said, we could do this too. Thank you, Socrates.
Beautiful. So there's a man behind every successful woman too. Could I invite Srimati Dr. R. Rangalakshmi on behalf of Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to come and say a few words, because then she needs to leave. She has a flight to catch. Ma'am, please.
Good afternoon to all. Greetings from M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation based at Chennai, India. I'm very delighted to receive this award on behalf of Professor Swaminathan. He's instrumental for increasing agriculture production in India. In the foundation, we have been working towards empowerment of women farmers to get the rights, to get the opportunities, and to equally play an important role in enhancing agriculture production. And he has sent a message through video. He could not able to participate physically in this meeting. On behalf of him, we are screening the video now. Thank you.
I am very grateful to the Women Economic Forum for both creating an award to recognize outstanding leaders, and also for selecting me for this award. I'm sorry I'm unable to be present personally due to health reasons, but I have requested my colleague, Dr. Rangalakshmi, Director of our Eco Technology Center, to receive the award on my behalf. After all, whatever I have done is with the help of a large number of young workers. We have tried to see how women self-esteem in villages can be enhanced. We have seen the transition from unskilled to skilled work, and above all, women farmers and women in farming have both been recognized in all of our projects in a very effective manner. When I was a member of Rajya Sabha, I also introduced a private member's bill to empower women in agriculture, women farmers. Women have never been recognized as farmers. In the National Commission on Farmers, we gave a definition of farmer, which includes women and men in the same, with the same rights and responsibility. Therefore, it's a real privilege to have been included in the category of people who have been recognized as having done some service to women farmers. I wish the Women Economic Forum great success in its efforts to enhance the role of women in the economic well-being of our country. In agriculture, if agriculture goes wrong, nothing else will go right. And agriculture will not go right unless women farmers are actively involved in every stage of planning and execution of agricultural policies and programs. Thanks again for this award, which I value very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Just to add, Professor Swaminathan is a very distinguished figure in the history of Indian agriculture's evolution. He's known as the father of the Green Revolution and has made great impact on agricultural productivity in India. He sends his best wishes. He couldn't be here. Thank you, Doctor, for representing Professor Swaminathan over here at the Women Economic Forum.
Thanks, Harveen. I now request Jyoti Deshpande, CEO of Eros International, to come up and please share her story with us.
Jyoti Deshpande?
She was here.
Is she here? Okay. You can move on.
I invite Maria Pavilione from Lithuania, a former MP and activist and one of the most well-known LGBT rights activists in Lithuania. Ma'am, we welcome you.
Dear sisters and brothers, it's a great honor to be today among you and with you. I cordially thank Dr. Harbin Aurora for inviting me to get this award. All my conscious life, as a university professor, social activist, and politician, I have been introducing to my Lithuanian society gender equality, gender balance, respect of human rights and freedoms, and women's reproductive rights. I have been fighting domestic violence against children and women, against homophobia, and against religious fundamentalism, which attempts to interfere into education and science in Lithuania. Highly respecting the code of All Ladies League, sisterhood, positivity, sharing, understanding, and love, I dare say that life, society, and individuals are the unity of contradictions, of values, and of old dogmas and stereotypes. In the age of constructing human rights and freedoms and gender equality, we are obliged to point the inequalities and negativities in order to build up more harmonious world. In this opening session of this morning, much has been said about specific feminine features which should be respected and revealed more. Dear sisters and brothers, I invite you to get rid of gender stereotypes because compassion, sensitivity, responsibility, and parenting are human features which should be bring up by education. All my life, I wrote and spoke about personality formation, about self-education, self-awareness, and self-realization. Men and women can be personalities or just members of the crowd without individuality and without personal identity. Only after one constantly grasps life contradictions, one is able to make one's personal choice, find one's personal life road, and strive for personal and social harmony. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. And we have back with us, we can't have enough of Raj Nayak. Sir, could you please join us on stage? The CEO of Colors Television and Rishte at Viacom 18. And he will come and share his words of wisdom through his life story with us. Let's welcome him, should we?
Thank you, Harbin, for inviting me to speak here today at the Women's Economic Forum. I'm truly honored to be here. This is the first time I'm speaking to so many women, galaxy of powerful, accomplished women from all over the world, and that makes me a little nervous. I'm not going to bore you with statistics or tell you something that you already don't know. In fact, if anything, I hope to listen to some of you and to take away something back from having come here. My name is Raj Nayak. I was born in a family of 5 children, 3 sons and 2 daughters. My grandmother lived with us. So if we did a quick count and included my mom and dad, we were 4 men and 4 women living under one roof. My life started with gender equality in the family. You know, I was lucky. I grew up in a household where the women were always treated equally. My parents didn't discriminate between brothers and sisters. My mother is 97 years old now, so you can imagine, even then, they were progressive in their thinking. When I got married and decided to have a child, we were hoping it would be a girl. And when we decided that she needs a sibling and planned to have another child, again we hoped to have a girl. We did. We were lucky. They say when you want something, the universe conspires to make it happen. I think for some reason, both my wife and I felt that it would be much easier to raise them as kids, so much more fun in dressing them up, and with so many in our society wanting only boys, somebody had to do the balancing act. I can tell you with conviction today, bringing up 2 girls has been the most joyful experience as parents. Having daughters is a privilege and not a burden. Being the father of 2 grown-up daughters, the issue of women's rights and women's empowerment is really, really close to my heart. In an ideal world, my daughters and all women will be able to live their lives on their own terms. Although we have made progress in the last few decades, we are still not where we need to be as a society. And that is very unfortunate. Look around you. In spite of the Women's Reservation Bill being first introduced almost 20 years back, it is still languishing to be passed in Parliament. Probably even lapsed. I don't know. I haven't kept a track of it, but maybe it's passed also, but I don't know. But it's taken 20 years if it has been passed. Just count the number of elected women in legislatures and in parliament, and it'll tell you a story in itself. But I must add, as our Honorable Minister, Sri Raghavendra Rathore, said in the morning, it seems or it is improving. In spite of a strict law against the concept of dowry, it still exists in some form or the other. And female infanticide is a reality. I remember once traveling, and you know, while I was traveling, I encountered somebody from an NGO telling me that in their research, they found out that there are rackets running in some states where doctors with mobile vans go into small interior villages parked in remote fields where sex determination is conducted inside the vans and abortion done. Now, this was a few years ago. Hopefully, things have changed, and I'm sure it has changed for the better. And let me remind you, all this is in spite of the fact that some of the world's elected leaders came from this subcontinent. Honestly, I find this ridiculous and frustrating. I'm sure some of you know this at the personal level. I've written a speech, and I've flown from Bombay, so let me speak. I'm sure some of you know that this at a personal level, that women today have to overcome inherent gender biases and systemic barriers to succeed. This is, to me, is painful on so many levels. Not just as a father of two strong women, but also as a human being. To me, advancing women's rights is not only an important issue, but also an urgent issue. And this is not because I have a wife, mother, sister, daughter. It is because I sincerely believe that women's rights are human rights. And when over 50% of our population have to struggle to be seen and to be heard, I think that this is a very big problem. My personal journey towards understanding this issue has been a long one. As a child, I really didn't notice these things. But as I grew older, I started seeing that in many ways, gender bias is inherent in our society. It bothers me when I read that women are told or expected to speak, behave, act, think, and even dress in a particular manner by not just other men, but other women also. Only when this mindset changes will women see progress. The most obvious example that comes to my mind is in the workplace, where the women have to work harder than men to prove that they deserve to be in leadership roles. Colors, YCOM 18, the organization that I represent, is one of the biggest examples where women dominate the channel in positions of power. The ratio of female to male employees is almost 70 to 30, 70% being women. My head of programming is a woman. All key functions are headed by women. Of the 10 people who directly report to me, 8 are women. That's the truth. Colors is largely run by women, and this is something we are extremely proud of. Our ambition is to demonstrate that exceptional and talented leaders can and should be women. One of the biggest hurdles women have to face often is to choose between societal expectations of getting married and having kids in place of continuing their careers. Men never have to choose whether they want to be fathers or have a career. Why should women have to go through that? Similarly, women shouldn't have to choose. I'm happy to share with you that we are among the first Indian companies to offer 9 months paid maternity leave and an additional 3 months paid leave besides flexible timings for women in our organization. We did this because we wanted to make sure that our female employees know that if they would like to continue their careers with us, we were happy to have them. At the same time, it is important to acknowledge that there is still a lot of work to be done. The glass ceiling still hovers above us, and I do believe that the media can be a tool to help make gender equality a reality rather than a far-off dream. The truth is that the media has a lot more power than we think of influencing young minds. Most of our population is filled with young people, and they turn to media to formulate ideas about the world, including gender roles. We shoulder a great responsibility to put our messages of equality. We are running short of time, so I'll cut a long thing short, but some things must be said. Media is empowering women in so many other ways too. Social media, for example, and we discussed about this morning, has given a lot of women a platform to express their views. Today, women all over the world are even marching and making their voices heard. You know, I heard in the morning session today that there are more number of women on social media than men. Now, just imagine for a moment, all the women in the world on social media decide to make their voice heard. Everybody will have to hear it, you know? So you too have a voice. And I urge you to make it heard as loud as possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Raj, for being an evocative cheerleader of womanhood. Thank you.
I want to say a big thank you to Raj and also to William Bissell, who's have to leave. William is the owner of Fab India, which we verily know, everyone knows, whoever comes from abroad goes to shop at Fab India. And thank you, William, for making Fab India bring us incredible India. Thank you, Raj, for those wonderful words on women in the media, and very, very inspired and very grateful for both your time here. Thank you, Mansi.
But the lunch isn't far. I just wanted to let you know, because lastly, we have a speaker, but in no measure the least, I call upon Nishi Vasudeva. She's the ex-chairman and managing director of Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited. Ma'am, could I invite you?
Not exactly a pleasant place to be standing between some very hungry people, including myself, and lunch. Good afternoon to everyone here, and thank you, Dr. Harbin and the Women's Economic Forum for inviting me here. And it's really an honor to be here amongst this galaxy of women from different walks of life and from so many different places and cultures. I'm not exactly going to be sharing any journey with you. I think there's a brief synopsis of who I am and what I've done, which is there on the website. And I actually thought I would just share some of my thoughts about the whole theme of this five-day program about creating, innovating, understanding, and driving the future, which is really a very powerful theme, and more so in today's world when life is changing at a pace which is much faster than has ever happened in the past. And as they say that even if you are on the right track, you have to keep moving lest you get run over. And I'm sure that during the next 5 days, the interactions and deliberations at this very unique conference would lead to a better understanding of people amongst the participants and generate some new thoughts for creating a better and brighter future for all of us and the generations to come. I think we are all living in this age of innovation. We've all studied about inventions in school, and they were the outcome of work done by truly gifted individuals, which brought about dramatic changes. But I think in the modern age, it's more about incremental innovations that are happening, and there's not a single eureka moment, but it's a continuum of steady disruptions which is being done, not necessarily by one individual, but more are being done by organizations. And I think in the organizational context, and I have spent my 39 years of my life working in an organization, it's all about staying ahead of the curve and improving on productivity and efficiencies and improving the bottom line, for which innovation becomes an absolute must. But having said that, and there are no real best practice solutions on innovation and how do you seed and cultivate innovation in an organization where the structures and processes which are followed by some can be very easily emulated, but finally it's the people and the culture that are the critical drivers of innovation. And such a culture has to necessarily be based on trust, where people understand that their ideas are valued, they trust that they will be heard, and risk-taking is encouraged without fear of failure. For a culture of innovation to thrive, there have to be leaders at every level who can not only visualize the larger picture, but more importantly, motivate people around them to turn their ideas into reality. And great leadership, to my mind, is all about empowerment. It's not about exerting power over others, but truly empowering people around you to become the best that they can be. And in just one sentence, I would like to share with you what has been my motto all throughout my working life of 39 years. I joined the organization at the lowest managerial level, and I retired last year as the chairman and managing director of Hindustan Petroleum, which is one of the country's top five companies, a very male-dominated sphere, oil and gas, but given equal opportunities, I think there is nothing women can do. And the fundamental thing which I have always followed is be passionate about whatever you do. Don't wonder who's going to let me. It's all about who's going to stop me. So thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy your lunch and the conference.
Thank you, ma'am. We need leaders at every level. Thank you for that. We'll remember that. Can I invite Dr. Betty Young, the president of the Hocking College, all the way from Ohio, USA. And I'd also mention she is the first woman president of the Hocking College. Warm welcome to you.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. I'd like to thank the Women's Economic Forum, Dr. Habib. I'm humbled to be among such an outstanding field of accomplished women and men that support us, celebrating all that we do to make a difference in the world. Trials and tribulations are gifts that make us who we are, stronger, sharper, kinder, more critical in the way we think. It's what we do with those trials and tribulations that determines the outcome. I graduated from high school in the United States in 1973 in a very rural area. My dad wanted boys and he got me. We farmed, and I grew up with a great life, but without a lot of opportunity for women in a rural area. Most of the girls I graduated with didn't go on to school, we didn't study. We just got married and had children and started a life. But 10 years after that, my life fell apart, and I found myself to be a single parent. I started taking classes at the local community and technical college. It was that changed my life for me and for my daughter. My daughter's with me. I'm really glad to be able to celebrate this moment with her. She's an attorney today, so obviously I'm a proud parent. But I tell you that because 20 years later, I became president and CEO of one of those two-year community and technical colleges. And it's my passion to assure that other women and people who live in poverty have the opportunity to find a pathway to prosperity through education and opportunity. And all of us here today, whether we own companies, we work in education, we work in the spiritual sector, we all have the opportunity to help others find their pathway to prosperity. I have a favorite quote. The author's unknown, but I want to share it with you. Work for a cause, not for applause. Live life to express, not to impress. Don't strive to make your presence notice. Just make your absence felt. I'll be speaking tomorrow at 2:15, maintaining integrity in the face of adversity. I hope you'll join me.
Thank you, Dr. Young. Can I invite, please, His Excellency Ambassador of Ecuador to kindly say a few words, please.
Sure. I invite Sukanya Mishra, the Senior Vice President and Group Head of MasterCard Labs, to kindly enlighten us.
Thank you very much, Women Economic Forum, and Dr. Harbin, for inviting me. It's indeed an eye-opener, and what a wonderful sight. Women make a wonderful place. Do you all agree? Yes, of course. It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to accept the Innovation Award on behalf of my colleague, Ms. Betty DeVita. She could not join us today because she is attending her son's graduation back in Miami. And that gave me this opportunity to meet all of you and be part of this forum. What a platform to network as well as learn from each other. Hearing all the wonderful speakers, it's truly inspirational. I would like to share Betty's acceptance that she sent to me. It is, you know, she has always expressed that, I'm just having a little difficulty with technology over here. Yeah. So she has always propagated that, you know, women, in order to grow and take more responsibility, need to take risk, thoughtful risk, and also take initiative, raise hands, so that we can pursue our dreams. And lastly, cherish the relationships of our lives and our family, because that is our true strength. In Betty's own word, thank you, Women's Economic Forum, for choosing me as a woman of the Decade in Innovation and Enterprise Award. We all know what it is like to be in the entrepreneur, both in careers as well as at home. But I believe that my husband had to be more of an entrepreneur, supporting me whenever I took a global position and moved from country to country. He had to quit jobs multiple times. That is he for she, supporting. Being a female leader has many challenges, and one instance during my global, in one of my global postings in the Far East, I had to meet a regional CEO of a large bank, and I had to sit next to a CEO's office, CEO's wife, till I had to explain to him that the meeting he was supposed to have was actually with me, Betty. And we, all of us, have faced such situations, definitely. What makes it fun is when you're with family and friends, and that's what MasterCard has been for all my life. And I definitely agree with that. Being able to innovate takes more than an individual skill and persistence. It has been very fortunate for me that I have been mentored and sponsored by many talented leaders, both men and women. I have worked in various countries like Canada, Korea, Latin America, and US, and the opportunity to diversify my skills and experience that has shaped me to be who I am. MasterCard allowed me to be a mom with flexible time, also be a mentor and best friend to the family, as well as be a leader. Though at one time, I thought my daughter has four moms, me and my three nannies. Well, I can relate to that pretty well. Women are the new engines of inclusive and sustainable growth, and the company, like MasterCard, recognizes that. Women represent 20% of the management committee and 25% of the board. We are a strong and mighty force, and together with our CEO, we fully are committed to make the world a better place for women with our efforts across the globe on multiple initiatives. We are helping women to come out of economic distress and be more empowered in financial inclusion. I really am honored to be here, and winning the award as well as my son's graduation from college and being able to celebrate it with my friends and family is priceless. So that's Betty DeVita for all of you. Thank you
so much, Sukanya. I wanted to also share that when I was reading about Betty, like you shared, she says two things I want to share with women. Whenever you get the chance, like Betty, she was in different countries, gained a lot of cross-cultural exposure, and was always there in the time of crisis and had to restructure a lot. And she said, do two things in your life. To women, she said, A, diversify your skills whenever you get the opportunity, and B, get global experience and exposure as much as you can get. And I can tell you, everyone at the Women Economic Forum is doing exactly that. So thank you so much, Sukanya, for that message.
Thank you, ladies. Can I invite Ms. Marisol Carranz, Deputy Chief of Mission from the Embassy of Chile, to say a few words? Can I invite you here, please? Thank you. On behalf of Fernanda Vicente, the president of Mujeres del Pacifico, please forgive my pronunciation, Women of the Pacific.
Mujer del Pacifico, I don't know. Mujer? I tried it in Spanish.
Mujeres?
Sorry, Portuguese.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Marisol Pérez Carranza. I am here today on behalf of my connational, the Chilean lady, Fernanda Vicente. She is the chairman of Mujeres del Pacifico. It's a very interesting organization in Chile that reunites women entrepreneurs in different matters and fields. And she has an extraordinary life, like all the women that we have listened today. And on behalf of Fernanda, I am very honored to thank the World Economic Forum for this award. Thank you very much to all.
Melanie and Georgina, come on over. Would you say a few words, please?
We also have video messages from Gina Reinhardt, who's the richest, not just the richest woman in Australia, but the richest person in Australia with a net worth of $8 billion or more. So we'd love to have, we'll have her video message later, but we'd love her goddaughters to say a few words if you'd like, since you were here. We will have it later. We'll have everybody who's on behalf of come, and then we'll do the
great
videos.
All right, okay. So that's something to look forward to. This is an absolute honor to be here accepting this award on behalf of our godmother. She is a fabulously inspiring woman to be not only the richest woman in Australia, but the richest person, kind of says she's, you know, blown right on through the glass ceiling. Not that money is everything, but it is just unbelievable to have such an amazing woman in our life, and we've been very lucky to be personally and privately mentored by her for our entire lives.
And first and foremost, the greatest gift she's ever given to us is the lesson that you can be strong and you can be feminine. And despite her incredible schedule, across all her enterprises and in her roles as patron and sponsor for our sport teams and the like, she never loses her grace. She's always warm and extremely generous with her time. And if you're lucky enough to know on a personal level, this is even more so.
And I think the most wonderful thing is she works really, really, really hard. And we've been witnesses to that. And so I think that's an amazing thing. Women can be strong and kind and generous and work hard and be successful. And this is amazing. And congratulations to all you women here for being here today. This is a wonderful event, and thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, beautiful ladies, coming all the way from Australia. Do we have Ms. Tanu Malhotra still with us? In that case, I invite you over. She's representing Shikha Sharma, the Managing Director and CEO of the Axis Bank.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of our MD and CEO, Axis Bank, Ms. Shikha Sharma, I take this opportunity to thank you for honoring her with Women of the Decade in Banking Award. Though our MD would have personally liked to be present here and accept this honor, we accept this award on her behalf with all humility. We have a small message from our MD and CEO, Ms. Shikha Sharma. To have this honor bestowed from an institute as credible as the Women Economic Forum is an overwhelming moment, and I would like to dedicate this to all my mentors and colleagues who have helped me in my professional journey over the years. India has come a long way since the time I started my career back in 1980, more so as the entire narrative about the existence of a glass ceiling for women is largely an unspoken subject now. In a financial services industry, especially, there has been a steady increase in women who take it up as a long-term career option. However, as a society, is there yet scope to increase even more females towards education? Definitely yes. Once again, I accept this award with grace and humility, and I wish that countries all over continue to nurture women leaders to realize their true potential. I wish you all a pleasant afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have Ms. Ragini Chopra with us? She was here earlier, I don't know. No. Okay. With that, we come to a close, near close of this session. We have the next session starting at 3 p.m. sharp. It's a power-packed session with the cabinet ministers of Slovenia, so you do not want to miss that. So I will suggest you grab your plates and bring them inside. We'll have 5 minutes to transition, and in the meantime, we're going to now watch the video messages from Gina Reinhardt and
Isabel Noboa,
and Fernanda Vicente.
Can over I lunch. Ask the AV team there, Surinder, to please get us the video of Gina Reinhardt, and I will request the panelists to please grab a bite at lunch. I know we are past our lunch time. Thank you for your patience, and thank you to everyone on the panel. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Namaste, distinguished guests and delegates. And hello to everyone in exciting and bustling New Delhi. Thank you very, very much for awarding me a Women Leaders of the Decade in Innovation and Enterprise Award. This is a significant honour, and I very much appreciate this kind gesture. I'm delighted my treasured goddaughters, Mel and Georgina, are here with you to accept this award on my behalf. Hi, Mel. Hi, Georgina. Thank you, and I hope you are having a wonderful time. Look forward to hearing lots more on your return. Bringing together over 50,000 members from across 150 different countries, the Women Economic Forum is undoubtedly an important organisation, and I am delighted to be included and invited to speak at your forum about creating, innovating, understanding, and driving the future. I hope you have an interesting forum and are enjoying making good friendships as you consider these important issues for the future. Thank you.
Good evening. Let me introduce myself. My name is Isabel Noboa, CEO and founder of a consortium of companies called Novis in Guayaquil, Ecuador, South America. My father, who based his life on values and principles, was a hard-working man and an outstanding visionary who from a humble beginning became the world's largest private banana exporter. He inspired me to do great things. I also inherited his love for math and finance. That gave me the drive to constantly learn on these subjects. When I turned 25, I founded FAM, a nonprofit foundation to shelter abandoned children while searching in Europe and America for their best adoptive parents and homes to cover their special needs. I therefore dedicated myself to this institution and put my heart and soul into it. The well-being of the children was our motivation to keep our volunteers interested. When my father passed away, my siblings and I had to look after the companies that became our responsibility. Novi started out in the middle of the largest financial crisis in my country's history. It was in these economic hardship that suddenly I had to find a way to pay off the debt the companies had acquired from their investments. We had a sugar mill with 15 acres of sugar cane plantations, a new shopping mall that had just opened its doors to the public, and a brand new real estate business that, because of the changes brought by the financial crisis, already needed to be reinvented. Having to even resort to barter for products and services so we could keep operating because the financial system had collapsed. We also had shares in Coca-Cola, where I had no control but only high particular debts. Our workforce was in dismay when they learned that a woman who had never led any institution other than a non-profit foundation would be at the helm. Personally, I decided to accept the challenge and sought the advice from a top entrepreneur. McKinsey, an international firm, was immediately hired to make an assessment of the firms I inherited. They were not happy with their findings. Fortunately, I was raised.
Thank you.
Could I request you lovely ladies and gentlemen to please take a seat? I don't want to interrupt your lunch, but you can bring your plates inside. Because we have a very exciting session ahead of us. Good afternoon to all. I know it's been a big afternoon, all for a good cause, and I now welcome you to a power-packed afternoon. We're in conversation with the cabinet ministers of Slovenia. It's my privilege to welcome on stage Ma'am Alenka Smerkol, the Minister for Development, Strategic Projects and Cohesion Slovenia. Please give her a warm round of applause. I I invite on stage Andrea Sipush, the founder and leading force of Envier, a social activist, creative communications professional, a mentor, and a host, as you can see. Welcome, Andrea. My privilege to honor next on stage, Sonia Schmutz, the executive director of the Managers Association of Slovenia. Welcome once again. And lastly, we are joined on the stage by Sonia Klopchik, the independent developer of collaborative leadership, coach, and speaker. She is also the author of 2 books on leadership and numerous leadership-related articles. I will request Mamelenka to kindly initiate this conversation and say a few words.
Welcome to Slovenia, green country with great people within European Union. Doesn't it seem like we have it all? Huh? Okay. Apparently it's not working well enough, so I'll start again. You saw the short clip. Doesn't it seem like Slovenia has it all? However, there are still great challenges in front of us, but don't get me wrong, we don't look at these challenges like threats, we look at them like opportunities, and we look at them of how we are able to grow and secure a better life for all of us. 2 million of us may be a small number of population compared to New Delhi, 22 million of people. Can you imagine a small suburb of New Delhi? This is what Slovenian population is. But what is important is that we take our future very seriously. And today, I would like to say a few words about our future. But however, before I do that, I would like to say that while talking about a better life and a better world, brighter future and more opportunities, we should not forget how much we as a whole of humanity have already achieved in recent decades. Just think about human rights, access to food, water, sanitation, gender equality. I will not go into numbers, but there have been tremendous global achievements in all these areas. Nevertheless, all this still present a great challenge for all of us. In 2017, we live in a hyper-connected world, which is defined by turbulence, uncertainty, ambiguity, and various novelties. Recent global and economic financial crisis did not reveal just deficiencies in our economy. It has also exposed other deficiencies, the most important one, lack of trust in all social areas. Trust among people all over the world has been radically depleted. Even though our quality of life across the world is improving rapidly, our societies are becoming less and less resilient. But now let's turn to Slovenia. Today, I will share with you a story, or better to say, the story of how we are co-creating our future together. Slovenia is a very young country that gained independence only 25 years ago. And like youngsters must make decisions about their adult life at that age, so must country about its future. This is why we have started asking ourselves what we want our country and our nation to be in the future. We quickly realized that when designing the future, you first need a vision. Any planning process first needs a vision. So over the past year and a half, we have worked tirelessly to engage with hundreds of Slovenians to define a society-wide vision of Slovenia 2050. The vision was released in February this year. Over 27 events with more than 600 people that participated directly, with much more than 1,000 people that really went for questionnaires on quality of life, this is how we somehow gained what we have in front of us. And what people really told us is now the vision of Slovenia. And the vision has 5 key elements that have emerged from all these discussions. And it's important to stress that elements are interlinked and complement each other. They are quality of life for all, learning for and through life, social innovation, identity, and thrust. And while the first three elements are pretty common in today's visions of countries all over the world, identity and thrust are unique. Preparing the vision, we came to realize that over the past years, we have unfortunately developed a habit of distrust, and the vision aims to change that. Finding the way to build trust in government, in institutions, and most importantly, among each other, will be vital for the future. The vision also already provides a common reference point for a new national development strategy 2030 that anticipates and prepares for societal needs, shifts, and also international commitments. Through this process, the vision is now being translated into action. Our main goal and strategic direction for the country is a better quality of life for all of us. And while we are already ranking among top 20 in the world on objective well-being indexes, people still feel unhappy. So when you look at our subjective life satisfaction indexes, we rank very low. Therefore, one of the biggest challenges is how to change perception of people and empower them to embrace their quality of life. Slovenia is also a country where gender inequality plays an extremely important role. Today, our government consists of 16 ministers, and 8 of us, so 50% of half of us, are women. 37% of our parliament members are women. And men and women in Slovenia have a very equal educational attainment and equal earned income. We rank 8 on the Global Gender Gap Index globally. Even though Slovenia ranks well on Global Gender Gap Index, we still face large inequalities in other areas. To tackle this issue, we must focus on inclusive growth. It is, however, important to keep in mind that inclusive growth can only be sustainable if it is achieved by preserving the natural environment. This urges us all to find an answer to a question: how to achieve a good growth, inclusive and green altogether, and we could perhaps even call it a well-being growth. Dear ladies and gentlemen, one of the results of our collaborative efforts to plant the first seeds of change towards realizing the vision of Slovenia is a group of great ladies with whom I have the honor and pleasure to attend this conference. And here they are. In Slovenia, women are strong seeds of change. We have grit, determination, and resilience, which sometimes men lack. Sonja, Andrea, and Sonja will share with us, with you, some thoughts on what they do. So I will now go to them and will continue from there. So, allow me to present the great ladies. The first one, Sonja Klapčič, please stand up. Engineer, manager, leader, and author. She has gained valuable experiences on top positions in a variety of organizations in Slovenia. The first one. The second one, Andreja Cepuš, yes, please stand up. A founder and leading force of Envir. She focuses on catalyzing collective potential towards co-creating the better future. Last but not least, Sonja Schmutz is an executive director of Slovene Executives Association. Woman again. Sonja is also a specialist on women leadership. So I ask you ladies to share the thoughts with us.
Thank you, Minister. I have to say I'm grateful to live in Slovenia and to have such a minister that we can show what collaboration among women really is. I believe that everyone has a potential to build leadership from inside, because for me, leadership is not connected to the formal position in an organization. It is connected with an open mind, with clear heart, and with the willingness to collaborate for a better world. And we need a lot of leaders. We need a lot of active citizens who are maturely enough to really express their needs, ambitions, and are willing to collaborate with trust with others for our prosperity, for the prosperity of all. My focus is business world, as already said, and my vision is collaborative leadership in the business world, where people are assuming responsibility for their development, starting from their thoughts to their words to their actions, and again collaborate to connect personal missions into mission of the organization and to reach the goals, collective and individually goals. And my mission is to develop as many leaders as possible. And I would like to enrich business language with words such as compassion, care, trust, support, and love. That's why I, for example, weekly publish ideas for leaders, which are inspirations, invitations, encouragement also, for leaders to try new approaches, to include new values into their daily life. And I'm also organizing dialogues about leadership of the new era with leaders who are already including universal spiritual truth in their business, daily business life. And I'm especially focusing on women, young managers. That's why I am the leader of Mentors Network, where seasoned, experienced managers, we are mentors for young managers, because we would like to encourage them to use their feminine power in the business. We need the balance of feminine and masculine power in the business. And of course, women, we are the one who can bring feminine power. So this is my contribution, that our vision, Slovenia 2050, will come true. And I promise I will continue.
Thank you, Sonia. And thank you. Hello first to everybody. And I also want to say I'm really grateful and actually honored that our minister is with us here and that she is actually hosting us here. That's really something to be, you know, an example for. And about me, you know, I believe that each one of us carries within a strength that can contribute to co-creation of better future. And my mission on this journey is to create supportive environment and opportunities so that this strength can step forward, that can show up, and that we can join these strengths then and create something better together. And how? So that we can deepen connection with ourselves, with nature, and that's why also with each other. I think these are the main feminine qualities also that are needed in today's world, everywhere. And you know, I'm hosting the events, the retreats, the workshops, specifically, and also programs specifically designed for bringing back to discover your true identity, your essence, things that brings you joy and passion and power. And I'm focused on women qualities, on feminine, authentic feminine principles, because on my journey as highly sensitive woman, stepping out of the systems, out of the managerial job and taking the solo entrepreneur's path, I learned that in order to survive in this world, I need to tap into my deepest wisdom. I need to tap into my intuition. I need to tap and really synchronize with a new way of being. Because in this highly volatile, ambiguous, and very complex world, you cannot do other but survive, but really step into this new way of leadership. And yeah, as one, you know, of the top 10 gender equality countries, Slovenia actually has this gender balance code within the structure, within our social structure. But still, in order for a true quality to come in, and these qualities are the warmth of inclusivity, the power of deep listening, the power of compassion, and also the power of this feminine, beautiful, hosting, nurturing energy. In order for these qualities to truly make a change, I think we need to re-empower them in both men and women, because we both have it. And in order to re-empower them, we need new way of learnings, new way of education. And we in Slovenia have understood this, that the change must happen on all levels. We know what to do, we have a vision, but it's also important how to do it. And these feminine qualities are saying how to do it. The change must happen on all levels in order to be sustainable, in order for the well-being of all that this can happen, in order for green growth to happen. So we have developed the model, the educational model, and we are starting it with a retreat, with the executive women leadership retreat that will be happening this year in October in Slovenia. And here we have actually developed a model that would have change in all the levels, in order of model, of program, of pricing, of sustainability, everything. And we identified three key pillars here. And these pillars are empowering feminine principles, understanding the masculine reality, because we need to understand what is the world and how these principles go together. And then also rebalance your life and renew your life. And these three pillars are the key pillars that can bring well-being into our world, not only personal, but they can foster the planetary transformation. So maybe Slovenia can be your next leadership destination. And yes, with this, I pass the word to Sonia. And thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll stand up if you don't mind, because I'll get a little bit warmer if I stand. First of all, this is a really inspirational conference with fantastic food, which is probably why there are not that many in the room now. And I can completely understand that, because I also had to be dragged in the room from the food to get. I work for the Men's Association of Slovenia. That is an association of Slovene top executives. And what we aim is to make leaders as good as they can be and better than they think they can be. And when we look at the results of the business results that the companies have that are led by our members, we found out that they are about, they pay higher salaries, 20% higher than the Slovene average. Their profit is almost three times higher than the Slovene average, and their turnover is almost 50% higher. So we don't say that we claim the results for that, but probably we have at least something little to do with this. Saying that, I also have to say that 70% of our members are men, 30% are women. And all of my career life, I've been actually working in masculine world, and I must tell you, I love it. It's great to be a good, successful woman in a masculine world. Because you really can shine. But then I thought, wow, what a selfish way of thinking. It's good that they're not they there, because I look better. But then you start thinking, well, God, but that's not okay. I don't want my daughter to be left out because somebody else was great, and she's not that great, or didn't have that opportunity. And then I started looking at my classmates from university. I know many, many women, girls that are better than I was. And I know many, many men, boys at that time that were quite okay, but not that great. And I could see many of them running Slovene companies, men. But I didn't see my girlfriends from university being there. And so from this high and full of self standpoint, I started thinking, well, there's probably something wrong with that picture. And I went deeper into this topic and saw that Slovenia, coming from ex-socialist country, in the 90s, we had a higher percentage of women in business than we have them today. And yet, we think that we are more gender equal than we used to be. On the World Economic Forum, the Global Gender Gap Report, we are number 8. We are one of the top 10 gender equality countries in the world. And we have so many things that are really good and making it possible for men and women to have their careers. Do you know that if you have a child, that you will have a 1 year maternity leave? 1 year? That once your child is 11 months old, because that's when it finishes the maternity leave, you can place him or her, your baby, in a kindergarten that is affordable, that is close to your home, and that child will not be just looked after, it will be also after, as they grow, they will be taught a lot of things. When our children go to school until the age of 10, we are pretty sure that they can be in their schools until 5 o'clock in the afternoon, which usually also collides with our working hours. and that they will be provided with hot meal in the schools. So if we think of that, and I talk with a lot of women from India, from UK, from anywhere, it's usually that a key problem that women face, and even after they finish studies, they think of, okay, once I want to become a mother, and then I will stay home, because it will be impossible for me to have it both. In Slovenia, we can have it both. And yet, ladies and gentlemen, when we come to the numbers of how many women there are in top positions, we are not doing much better than the rest of the world. We have many women working, many middle women in middle management, but on the top positions, we are still very rare. We are very happy that the government is putting things pretty much forward with showing a good example of 50-50. We have a lot of also men leaders that believe that they are promoting gender equality, but they cannot prove it with their results. That's why in the morning session I said that we have to do much more, and that leaders have to understand that it is their job not just to offer you a promotion, but it's their job to make it possible for you to accept the promotion, because you as a woman are needed for the company. And also different kind of men will probably be able to climb the corporate ladder, and not only one type that we see as a dominant model for being a top leader. I think that I've exceeded my time, so I'll just stop and say thank you. And for all of you that would like to learn a little bit more of why Slovenia is a top 10 gender equality country, we'll be having a special session tomorrow, I think at 12 and something. At 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So you're invited, and we'll be happy to share our stories and listen to more of yours. Thank you.
Sonia would like to address you with one more sentence.
Yes, one more sentence from my side would be to encourage a woman to take really position with the power. When women have the chance to make impact, to change the world. I also wrote a book from my stories, from ups and downs, that the book shows the human side of the business, not just human, women's side of the business. And this is as a support for all of us to take this position on power and to change the world, because this is our responsibility.
Okay, we are coming to an end with what we want to say to you. And I will just finish with a few sentences. I think you now better understand why Slovenia, with such great ladies, has the power to move on. Slovenia also wants to be a very responsible global citizen. And while we are really setting our own path towards living well, we are acutely aware that we have our shared responsibility for global peace and prosperity. And this is why what I was saying earlier, that we are really working on our new long-term strategy, we have merged two processes. One is deciding on how we want to live, and the second one is that we are embracing the Sustainable Development Agenda 2030 in our goals, in our long-term strategy. This means that Slovenia is a pioneering country in that, and it we basically officially recognized sustainable development goals as an integral part of our long-term development. I think this is really crucial, not just for us, for the world, the small world we live in, but for the whole planet, because I truly believe this is the only right way to go if you want to save this beautiful planet. And at the end, just let me remind us all that it is within power of us, of power of all individuals and also, of course, governments to make the world a happier place. Thank you. And now, Herbin, we would really ask you to just join us on stage because we have a small present for you as well. As I said, Sonia did write the first book on leadership in Slovenia, and she's a woman. And we want you to have a copy of Sonia's book. Thank you very much. A little bit of intimacy.
Thank you so much, Minister, and lovely ladies. Thank you so much for a very interesting discussion and for sharing with us a slice of Slovenia. Thank you. We'll take a short 5-minute break. Grab your cookies and your coffee. Because we will start an interesting session on creating a new ecosystem for education, learning, design, and lifestyle. We begin that at 3:45. Please be with us. Thank you.
I'm a state-level cricket player. I've pursued my love for cricket since I was 10 years old. And it's finally brought me to the stage of being the leader and captain for the Delhi team. I play cricket every weekend with my friends. and also join the team during tournaments and competitions. There's only one thing I love as much as my cricket. It's brewing coffee and working as a barista at Pullman Hotel in New Delhi Aero City. I'm part of the team here at Cafe Pluck. We make some of the best coffees in town. No, honestly, I'm a barista, I should know. What makes it fun here is the team, the hotel, and how it allows us to celebrate our passion outside of work. Choosing one passion over the other is kind of a very emotional thing for every person, especially for me. At Pullman, I don't have to do that, thanks to our 5-day work week. 2 days off every week to do whatever we want, whatever we love. There's a big match coming up this week. I've trained well enough, I think, but I'm still a little nervous. After all, being captain for Delhi deaf and mute cricket team is no small task. I've faced a lot of difficulties in life, but if you don't celebrate what you have, you'll lose everything that's left. I'm Tamkin. I'm a heartist at Pullman, and I'm here to celebrate you.